Right, okay. Good morning and welcome to the 10th meeting in 2016 of the Finance Committee of the Scottish Parliament. Could I remind everyone present to turn off any mobile phones, tablets or other electronic devices? We've received apologies from Gavin Brown, MSP, and Jackie Bailey, MSP, has indicated she will arrive later in the meeting as she's attending another committee for its first item of business. And also understand that Leslie Brennan, MSP, may have to duck out at some point to go to another committee, which is also on at the same time, to apologise to all our guests for that. This doesn't usually happen, I have to say. It's just that everything's very hectic running towards the end of the session. So our first item on our agenda is to decide whether to consider a draft annual report and legacy paper in private at our future meeting. Are members agreed?
Yes.
Members have indicated the agreement. Our second item of business is to take evidence in a roundtable format on prevention. We've been monitoring progress on the decisive shift to prevention throughout the current session, and we'll take evidence from the Deputy First Minister later this morning and set out conclusions in our legacy paper in a fortnight. I intend for this session to be relatively informal with flowing discussion based on the following three themes. What progress has been made towards a shift to prevention since 2011? The challenges that lie ahead in ensuring the shift towards prevention and possible solutions to overcome these challenges. And I'm hoping to spend around 30 minutes on each of these themes. Now, how this will work basically is that I'm going to actually ask Rachel to kick us off in a wee minute, because what she said in her response is that progress is being made by many organisations on the ground in terms of the way in which they're looking at work and prevention. So I'll allow you to continue from that. And once you've spoken, then anyone just simply indicate to me if you want to come in, and you can either comment on what Rachel has said or you can add your own comments, and we'll try and keep the discussion as free-flowing as possible and involve as many people as possible in the discussion. So, without further ado, Rachel.
Thank you, Convener, and thanks for the opportunity to open. I would emphasise that it is our opinion that there is an awful lot of good practice around prevention, and I think that came up very clearly in the submissions from the other partners around the table who were giving their own examples. In terms of nursing and the nursing workforce, we've been doing some work over the last couple of years to really highlight where nurses are starting to make significant inroads around reducing health inequalities in particular and dealing with prevention. We published a report just over a year ago which profiled a number of nurses working across Scotland dealing with areas such as criminal justice, bloodborne viruses, and people with mental ill health and suffering from homelessness, and looking at the impact those nurses were having in trying to prevent further ill health or further negative outcomes for those particular people. And what I would say is we came to a number of conclusions. One is quite often those nurses were managing to do what they were doing because they were working slightly outside of the system. They were willing to take risks. Dare I say many of them were coming towards retirement, and on that basis were perhaps able to take more risks than perhaps their younger colleagues felt able to do. But the work that they were doing was absolutely fantastic, and we were really proud as a college to showcase that. We've also done some work recently looking at prevention within remote and rural areas and how nursing staff are working particularly with older people who may find themselves particularly isolated because of where they happen to live. And again, that has shown some really fantastic examples in our remote and rural health boards of where nurses working with colleagues across health and social care and often with agencies beyond health and social care are doing fantastic work and using what they do have available to them to really make a step change difference. The health visitors that we have been successful in securing 500 new health visitors, which are currently going through training. And I think the reports, including the one from your own advisor to the committee, has particularly shown the need to ensure that. And there's been work through the CNO's review of health visiting to extend the work that health visitors does. There is now additional visits within the pathway. And I think that early intervention is really key within that universal package available to every single family within Scotland as a core embedded approach to how we stop long-term health conditions and long-term inequalities arising from the very beginning. So they are just some examples. I think our difficulty often in Scotland is how to scale those examples and to take the learning from those particular individual projects and programmes and turn that into a far more sustained way of working. And just briefly to touch on your second question, sometimes that's because the way in which we define what we think of as success in the public sector doesn't always work in our favour to do that.
Thank you very much. Deputy Convener.
Thanks. I enjoyed the paper from the RCN as usual. I mean, you say that you feel very little has changed in the last 5 years, and I'd be interested to know if other people feel that's the case as well. And I mean, you talk about reducing demand in hospitals and presumably freeing up resources for other purposes. I mean, should we just go ahead and close a few hospitals and that would free up resources?
If only life were that simple. In terms of the first comment, we were referring specifically to some of the issues we've raised with Committee 5 previously when we responded to your first inquiry in this. And some of the issues we raised there certainly haven't been addressed. Have there been changes on the ground? Yes, I would say that there have. In terms of freeing up the acute sector, what we have is an issue where we have an ageing population with complex needs. One of the difficulties that we're going to have in terms of freeing up resource is everything in the acute sector it becomes more expensive. The more we try to deal with people with complex needs at home, the more we're looking at our acute sector becoming one where the needs are ever more complex. The specialities that we're going to need, the number of staff that we will need, will become more expensive. I don't think it's a simple equation between freeing up money from the acute sector and freeing that up to put into primary prevention, primary care. It's simply not a simple equation. If it were, perhaps politicians would have already gone down the line that you're suggesting. And to date, that's not been something that seems to have been particularly palatable as a way forward. So I would hesitate to say that it is a simple equation. What we have to do is be clear what we want our acute sector to do in the future. And to do that, we also need to be clear what it is that we want to provide in the community. And we have to be much clearer about our priorities. And that comes really back to the work that we did with the Academy of Medical Royal Colleges last year on sustainability and the work that we've continued as a college. And I hope members of the committee have seen our recent work on targets, which we are continuing. Unless we can be absolutely clear what our priorities are as a country and politicians are clear what they are in terms of how they go out to the public sector and beyond to ensure that there is a single, joined up, coherent framework that sets out what those priorities are, is clear about what success looks like, and allows those who have control of the money to choose where to spend that money wisely to the best ends, then I think we probably are on a bit of a hiding to nothing. Some of those questions will then maybe answer your other questions about what we choose to invest in and indeed what we choose to disinvest in. They will be hard decisions to make over the coming years.
Thank you.
Thank you, Colin. To be followed by Justina.
Largely reflect what Rachel's been saying in terms of. Oh, sorry, did you say Colin followed by Justina? Great. Mr. Mayor.
I think Justina was much more interesting than I am anyway. I mean, really, just 2 points I think pick up on Rachel. There's a bit which I tried to focus on briefly about what we mean by shift anyway, and I think it's as much about a shift of stance, how we use resources that are already there, as it's about major budget shifts in the current budget, because the honest truth is, if you look at your own projections of the likely current budgets in Scotland across the next 5 years, major shift within them is actually profoundly unlikely because of the pressures all around the system. What I would say, and I think it is heartening, is looking across a whole variety of local services, and schools would be a good example. They are thinking prevention and early intervention in a quite different way now. So if you said to me, are there more teachers there? No. Are there different resources there? No. It's how people are thinking about and using those resources, particularly with vulnerable children and families, how they're thinking about the type of teaching that will engage children who struggle with some conventional forms of academic teaching and so on. So I think there is a bit when we talk about shift, I think a huge shift of attitude and stance has taken place. That all hasn't always meant that if you looked at the budget of a council, for example, you would note major chunks of money going from A to B, but it's how people are using resources on the ground. And indeed, I think a lot around localisation and people working together in quite new and innovative ways across services and agencies at very local levels, again, is about prevention. They are coming together to try and stop predictably bad things happening to communities and to households, and by working in new and innovative ways of doing that. I think the second thing, and it picks up in perhaps the hospital community issue, there are some areas where if we are convinced there is long-term payoff in developing preventative capacity in communities. I wonder whether we shouldn't see it as an investment proposition and not a current budget proposition. If all of this is to come out of the current budget and it's highly pressurised just now, I'm not sure how much will actually happen. If we are confident we understand the preventative levers, we could borrow and fund things over time that will reduce the future pressures and cost structures within our system. So I think there is a bit of looking at the meaning of prevention. If we're going to get benefits across 30 years by intervening now, normally when we have that proposition, we treat it as an investment proposition. We borrow fund it so the flow of costs and the flow of benefits more or less fit together over time. And I wonder whether we're not looking enough at where an actual investment model would make sense if we want to get a significant shift to prevention.
Thank you, Justina.
Why, thank you. I will now come in. I think a lot of people around the table will reflect both what Rachel and what Colin have been saying in terms of all the themes across different policy areas. In terms of justice, I think, what have we achieved over the past 5 years? I think there is a better understanding of the importance of the early years for justice as well. And in our written submission, we commented that John Carnahan didn't ever achieve his ambition of 1,000 new health visitors rather than 1,000 new police officers within his time at the Violence Reduction Unit. But I think we would all welcome the 500 new health visitors now who are coming into post to support the Children and Young People's Act. And we will see the impact of that in the justice system as well. So I think we're all very bought into that argument. In terms of justice in particular, I think the progress we've made over the past 5 years has really been that people are beginning, and only just beginning, to see that prevention can happen at all stages of the justice system. It isn't just about keeping people out of first-time offending, and we can all introduce more preventative thinking, as Colin has said. And I think people are beginning to ask more of the why question. Why are people offending? Not just kind of what have they done and when did they do it, but why have they done it? And we need to answer those why questions around bereavement, trauma, loss, mental health, learning disability, addictions, all of those linked factors. I think we've also achieved over the last 5 years some very promising evidence in relation to mentoring support. That's been delivered largely through public social partnerships, and they are everything that Christy talked about in terms of co-design, co-production, working together between the third sector and the public sector, delivering that sort of real hands-on practical support to people in the justice system in a very stickable way. It's asset-based, it's person-centred and so on. And that's only been possible thanks to a very significant investment from the Scottish Government and other funding partners. And that's really let us deliver that sort of proof of concept. We know it works. And it's had a real impact on individuals. So I think we've talking about investment rather than spending, I think it's very important. I think we're already seeing a significant return on some of those new models of investment. And it doesn't always take a generation to achieve that.
Okay, thank you. Alan, to be followed by Nick.
From the third sector point of view, there is a strong feeling that there can be no decisive shift in policy unless there is a reciprocal shift in the way that funds are allocated. I'm not talking about the funds themselves, I'm talking about just where they go and who allocates, who brokers them. Diversion and prevention are generally seen as non-core activity and therefore always come second place to the provision of those core actions. And where funding goes directly to a major provider of core funding, then that is quite clearly their priority. It is much more common, we're finding, and very much over the past decade, that non-core external activity is the first target and always will be when savings and changes have to be made. So while we might be seeing, as has already been said, really innovative work within larger organisations to change the way they do things, nevertheless, that is not reciprocated. That tends to be in-house. It tends to be held in-house because the prime responsibility or prime motive appears to be how do we keep this particular silo operational. The third sector has suffered quite badly over the past decade and continues to do so as we see a retrenchment And we do believe that there is a sense in which this is a loss. This isn't a bleat. It's not likely to be any different. But we do believe that there is a loss of opportunity because there's an awful lot of potential resource, a lot of good thinking, a lot of real innovation, a lot of goodwill, which could be better used. And we just feel that there is an opportunity to think rather bigger. And maybe we can't do that until we make prevention a core activity rather than a non-core activity.
Thank you. Next, followed by Elaine.
I just endorse what the previous speakers have all said. I think we're seeing a lot of evidence of prevention from very small-scale projects, such as Operation Modulus in the Gorbals, working with 12 people who were a very long way from the mainstream, which produced real significant results. And we can actually start looking at costings emerging with cut downs in graffiti, no evictions, and things like that. So we can actually see evidence of savings coming through small projects on prevention. I think the problem that we're finding is that models of prevention, where people set up initiatives that are aimed at prevention, can very, very quickly get drafted into the mainstream. So, for example, because of needs. So, for example, the other week we've been doing work around health and social care integration, and I was speaking to a group of district nurses who had set up a program that was originally about preventing people going into hospital, and it was set up to provide family support, and it very quickly became a model about helping people get out of hospital, because that was the need although both are prevention and both will lead to a reduction in bed usage, you could argue, we're not doing the economic analysis of saying, is it better economically to be stopping people going into hospital, or is it more efficient to be getting people to come out? And I think there's a need to develop more efficient and more robust models to economically evaluate whether or not we place care or we place support in this sector, or we do something here, there. And I think Colin's idea of borrowing now to achieve upfront, we need good, sound, robust models to be able to say, right, if we do this now, we will save this in 10 years, 20 years, 30 years time, so we can make that. And I think that's one of the things that we need to be developing more of.
Aileen, followed by Aileen.
I just wanted to say about the third sector, there's lots of really small organisations doing significant pieces of work which are really fundamental to prevention, and that's, I'm talking about small lunch clubs, coffee clubs that make a real difference to people and are a way of engagement and helping them progress. However, they're the things that often will get cut in terms of funding first. Trusts and foundations will often pick up those costs, like ourselves, and they'll pick up costs such as running costs, admin, heating, lighting, which will often get missed as well. If we're going to help with prevention, we need to think of those small scale models. Also, to come on the back of Nick's point, we recognise the importance of strong evaluation with all the work that we do, but we want to really try and get people to measure the difference and the impact they're making first and foremost, and understand what that looks like before we can really understand what the economic value is. If we know we're making the difference first, then we can look at the replication and then the economic value of that. So I would say that we need to get better at helping people demonstrate the impact they are and how that feeds into the bigger systems and structures, which I think a lot of people find challenging just now, particularly in the third sector.
Okay, Aileen, to follow by Deputy Convener.
I would absolutely echo and reiterate everything that has been said so far on the themes of using the resources that we already have and being much smarter about how we do that, about sustainability and the amount of short-term funding versus long-term investment, and about actually joining up to get some national traction on all of the issues that have been talked about. Because we do seem to have spent a lot of time, lots and lots of good practice and lots of pilots going out, I've got lots of examples, but we tweak around the edges rather than have anything which really actually gets to the nub of the whole thing. And you'll see from our response was particularly talking about the safer use of medicines. And it's a part of the equation, but it runs as a thread right through the NHS. And we spend 1.4 billion on medicines, which is only the second only to salaries in the NHS, but we know that only about half of those are used as they should be. So there's a huge amount of scope there for safer use of medicines. And talking about unplanned admissions to hospital, we know that a huge number of the unplanned admissions to hospital, thousands, are actually because of medicines-related incidents. So if we can actually focus more on preventing those, which we would say is using pharmacists where you have medicines and where you have patients, getting the expertise where we really need it in the system, if we could save on even a small percentage, because I know you all know the maths on how much hospital admissions cost, we would actually be saving a huge amount for the NHS, but more importantly, we would be keeping people safe at home, in their own homes, where they want to be. So I think we have to actually start to think cohesively as a whole about, you know, how medicines fits into the whole health picture and to the other, and the health and social care integration agenda.
Okay, thank you, Deputy Convener, to be followed by Andrew.
Yeah, there was two follow-up questions to two of the contributions so far. For Alan's staff, I mean, I'm a fan of the third sector, but to be devil's advocate for a minute, does it really matter who does it? I mean, surely the important thing is that we're doing preventative spend, investment, etc. Does it matter if it's the public sector or the third sector? And for Colin Mair, whose paper I thought was great, I mean, are you basically saying we can't measure prevention because it's all about attitude, so it's all inside people's heads? And how do we measure it? We're the Finance Committee. How do we measure these things?
I'll let you come straight in on that specific, Colin, if you want
to answer. I mean, to me, I would measure it. Prevention is about how do we stop negative outcomes happening to people and how do we promote positive outcomes. By definition, therefore, as the law now says, the Community Empowerment Scotland legislation, all public authorities will have a duty to show how they're improving outcomes, how they're preventing negative outcomes, and the guidance for that, I think, comes out very, very shortly. So, to me, prevention is about how do we improve outcomes, particularly for people who in the past would have experienced negative ones. We can track that, and we should be obliged to publish that and be accountable for that to yourselves, to our local communities and populations as well. So I think focus on the outcome. Prevention is another way of talking about outcomes. If we can predict where negative outcomes will occur, we have a duty under law now to intervene and ensure that that does not happen to people. We will have to give an account of that, and we will have to measure those.
Right, prevention is the same as outcome.
Well, I think we're using different languages often in quite similar ways. So the languages around co-production, for example, are often languages that are saying, do it this way because the ways we've done it in the past have excluded people. The language about prevention, therefore, to me, intimately links with the language of community empowerment and co-production. Very simple example, I was at a meeting recently where a group of quite articulate community representatives were complaining to a council that changes to the allocation of personal care at home was leading to older people being lonely and isolated. And everybody bought into it. And it was myself thinking, that's a really weird proposition about a community. That the answer to the loneliness of older people in this community will be a salaried state personal care worker. Where is the community in that? You know, don't we have to then do some of the capacity building stuff and so on that's saying we'll never be able to stop loneliness as public services. You as communities need to be active at noticing where older people are isolated, integrating them with activities and so on. And the third sector, I do think, going back to Alan's point, has an absolutely critical role there because it is much, much more able at mobilising communities than the public sector has historically proven to be. So I think a lot of the languages we use are all linked to outcomes. How do you prevent negative ones? How do you ensure positive ones? And I think the answer is if preventative intervention was working, the outcomes will shift. If they don't shift, the preventative intervention is not working. And I think we call too much prevention because of the type of thing it is, without asking the question, did it actually produce the result? Because if it doesn't produce the result, it hasn't been preventative. Right. It's just been another thing.
Okay, thank you. Yes, don't worry, Alan, I'll let you in, but I've got a few other people before you, I'm afraid. Andrew, followed by John.
I agree with what Colin's just said. Our submission to the committee highlighted a number of examples in the third sector where preventative work's going on, for example, the food train, which run in a number of different local authorities in Scotland, which providing a volunteer-delivered service to older people in terms of food and nutrition. The Good Morning Service, which makes phone calls to older people to make sure that they're well and staying well. And I kind of think that volunteer-delivered type service, that that's really where the third sector comes into its own in terms of some of this work, not solely where the third sector thrives, but really, really good examples in that. I guess one of the things that the Alliance would reflect on would be about the culture within statutory services. And I think that comes into sharper view when you've got different policy initiatives. So in the last few weeks, the government's produced the National Clinical Strategy, which has lots of really good stuff in it around about self-management, harnessing personal and community assets, the sort of things that Elaine was talking about earlier on as well, the types of local things in communities. Those shifts are really necessary, but are they going to happen without the necessary culture change? What are we doing to invest in that change management that needs to happen to push us towards a preventative approach? And how can you change a culture when there are lots of practitioners working in really tight budget circumstances and within a target-driven system quite often, which is working around about restricted eligibility criteria or targets and indicators which are based on measuring service failure rather than individual outcomes.
Thank you. Mark. Given that I don't have the subject and sector-specific knowledge that many of our colleagues have around the table, so my remarks are probably more general. I'm also struck by the interrelationship of your three questions and how we inevitably drift in and out. A couple of observations. It seems to me that there's a great opportunity here for Scotland, as a relatively small nation, to move quite quickly and move several steps in this area. And the progress I would identify in the last few years is perhaps that there is a greater awareness now of prevention, preventive spend, and its associated term, collaboration. There is a lot of rhetoric around prevention and collaboration. And inevitably, I think all these remarks are tinged with a but and a however, as we're hearing, because the rhetoric and the practice may be different things. I think there are a lot of good practices, and I'll return to one or two examples shortly, but there are many more, much better examples from around the table. I think the point the Improvement Service make about the terminology, about what we mean by prevention, and about its potentially comprehensive and long-term nature, as has already been mentioned, is a really important point. I identify, and as a person who's moved from the adversarial world to the cooperative consensual world as a mediator, and it is writ large in this world, love prevails. I'm interested in what I think is a global trend, and that is a move from an unhelpful competition in the adversarial sense towards a greater awareness of working better together, collaboration. And I think that what comes out of some of the papers and where some of the frustration lies is that an understanding of better working relationships and of the need to work better in partnership and relationship is now quite profound and quite enlightened. However, the but is there's a long way to go in terms of turning that into practice, but certainly across sectors and within sectors, there's much greater awareness or evidence of awareness of the importance of relationships, communication, and so forth, rather than mere systematic change, and it makes something that gets stuck on systems. You ask, however, in this section about progress, and let me just give a few examples. I had the privilege just 10 days ago of giving the keynote address at the Scottish Knowledge Exchange Awards, run by a body called Interface. The Interface literally are an interface between the university publicly funded sector and small businesses and other creative folk. Great example of people getting together and doing all sorts of exciting things which are essentially preventative in their nature by nature of what they are. The Scottish University's Insight Institute, run by my colleague Charlie Woods, which brings universities together to be more collaborative and to create and develop new ideas. In this very building, just a few weeks ago, the Apologies Scotland Act 2016 was passed and received royal assent last week. Now, that doesn't sound immediately like a preventative measure, but of course it is, because the whole underlying premise of apology is if people are able to say, I'm sorry for what happened, or I'm sorry that that occurred, or whatever it might be, we know from the evidence and experience that many fewer claims will be brought. That's preventative spend. From my own experience in the work that we do, a significant number of public sector leaders have now trained in mediation skills and collaboration, and they're taking this into their various organisations and using collaborative and preventative techniques. So I think come back perhaps to training in due course. And the Scottish Government has begun to appreciate the value of using mediation, for example, to nip things in the bud. And there are lots of buts attached to that as well. So evidence of some progress, much rhetoric, a lot of awareness, and the buts will come under your challenges and solutions headings.
Well, I mean, that brings me swiftly on to the challenges that lie ahead, and I'm hoping folk will look at that, because when you look at the challenges that lie ahead in ensuring shift towards prevention. Mark, to fall by Leslie.
Thank you, Convener. And it's quite handy that you've moved on, because my question was kind of tailored around more probably the second theme than the first theme. Well, there you go. I'm always happy to help. I guess there are a couple of questions. The first is around how we tackle some of the silo mentalities that still exist. And I don't mean necessarily silo mentalities between different sectors. Often within, if you take health as an example, within health, there can be a silo mentality between the acute and the primary, or even within the primary between different disciplines. And how do we tackle that and get more of a collaborative approach, which I think would help in terms of the points that Aileen is making, where, for example, in a lot of areas now, people are being guided more to present at the pharmacist rather than the GP, because very often the GP is finding that when a patient comes to sit down in front of them, they probably would be better dealt with either by a pharmacist or by another primary care professional. But they don't know that until the point the individual is sitting down in front of them. So that then, you know, creates a pressure on GP time, and that works its way up through the system. The second question I was going to ask was about the challenge that is always there between the quick short-term fix and the longer-term solution. And, you know, it's no secret that we as politicians, whether at a local or a national level, operate within a 4 or 5 year cycle. How do we get out of the mentality of we need something that will work within 5 years that we can present and show, look, this has been fixed, rather than something that maybe will take 10 to 15 years and we can look at and say there's progress, but there's more to do? And how do we ensure that we get a kind of a buy-in to that?
OK, Leslie, to be followed by Alan.
After Mark's.
Seamless system.
It's a
collaborative. Because Colin had noted about measuring prevention success by almost measuring outcomes, whether they're negative or positive. So I wonder what the panel members think about identifying interim outcomes. So, like, for example, in health, if you're aiming to reduce cardiovascular events, such as heart attack, strokes, or CVD-related deaths, you then identify a group of interim measures, like, and then measure it. So, like, whether it's what's the local area's changes in good and bad cholesterol, maybe their weight, smoking rates, maybe diabetes. Just yeah. So about rounds about interim outcomes.
Before by Rachel.
So, Convener, I was just really responding to John's question, and hopefully doesn't...
Good, that's what we want to do, stimulate a bit of debate.
Doesn't take us back. Very simply, if it's the case that there is no difference between the cost-effectiveness of the various approaches, if it's the case that users are fully engaged in designing and evaluating the process, and if it's the case that accountability is roughly equivalent, then no, it doesn't matter. But hand on heart, that is not the case. If it's not the case, then there is a need to actually say, yes, it does matter who delivers these things, because we need to be sure that we're getting not only good value for money, but also buy-in at local communities, actually effective services, not simply ones which fit the services which are, or the service operational approaches which are being delivered at this moment.
Supplementary, John.
Are you saying then that the third sector is a particular strength in the preventative arena?
Yes.
Or are you just saying that the third sector is better at everything?
No, I'm saying we're talking about preventative. The third sector, as has already been stated, has a particular ability to mobilise local communities. It's very much part, derived from part of local communities, and generally is very, very active in mobilising communities. those same people. So, for instance, if I can give you an example, we focus very much on creating peer mentors. So we will take those people who we are working with initially to prevent them from going on to becoming the future offender. But we will work on making those individuals who will go out and work with their peers and do the same thing. So it's a sustainable, it's a community sustainable approach, and it builds on the strengths and the assets of the community. Not doing to the community, but working alongside and with the community. Third sector is absolutely excellent at that. Yes.
Thank you. Rachel, followed by Jean.
So to pick up on the two questions that came as part of the second part of the debate, I think the issue around measurement and the issue around, to borrow one of my colleagues' phrases from their written evidence, how you get to that point of productive collaboration are really linked. And we did some work at the beginning of the Great Integration Journey where we put some principles for delivering integration out, and we did a lot of consultation. And what was at the heart of that was really what everything tells us across the world is if you want to collaborate effectively, you need a shared vision. And actually, you need everyone to be able to come behind that. If you're all working to different understandings of what you're doing, and sometimes that comes down to language, I think you can even see that in the submissions, but if you don't have a clear idea of what you're aiming at, it's very hard to get people behind you. And part of that is about what you choose to prioritise and what you choose to measure. What does success look like in this world? Unless we all know what that is, it's very hard to expect frontline practitioners to really coalesce behind that single vision. And we have a number of statements in different policy arenas in Scotland. They don't always necessarily match. The paper that Audit Scotland produced last week on community planning, I thought, was very, very helpful. And I know some of it was referencing your work at the Improvement Service. But when you look at the number of indicators and outcomes that the public sector is having to work to and the disparate nature of what that is, and then you expect a frontline nurse, a frontline GP and a frontline social worker to make head or tail of that, then I think we have a real problem. So I think there's a political issue, and I think there is a practice issue here. I would very much endorse what Audit Scotland have said about how do we streamline that. We do have, for example, I know people have mentioned the Community Empowerment Bill. We now have National Health and Wellbeing Outcomes set into the Public Bodies Act. I know there's a lot of support for what's in there, but how do we, as Audit Scotland have pointed, that didn't replace, it just added to existing measures. And driving to work this morning, I was listening to the radio, and there was a very interesting piece of local news in which it was probably the main story for the local news, where it was reporting on a particular health board who'd missed its A&E target by 0.1%. Though if you had actually changed the dates at which you were looking, it actually met it. Now, was that the biggest health issue in that area of Scotland? I very much doubt it. But what we end up with is in a debate on the margins when actually we have in front of us some really significant issues. But I agree with both of you that there is a political pragmatism about how do you report on whether you are investing your money and your resources and your priorities in the right places. So I would very much agree that there is a need in the long-term outcomes to have indicators along the way that will allow all of us to see, have we made the right choices? Because maybe if we haven't, then we have to review what that choice has been. And we can't wait 15 years to keep putting money in the same place. But that also requires us to be brave about what we choose to measure. If what we want is a paradigm shift in how we deliver services across the public sector, whether that's prevention in terms of criminal justice or in terms of healthcare or in terms of poor educational attainment, in some ways it doesn't matter. We still need to be brave about how we look at the measures and how we look at the indicators. If we tell our public agencies that support us to do that, there is no money to develop new measures. There is nothing here. You just need to keep going with what we've measured in the past. Then what we will get is what we've done in the past. And there is a really strong correlation between your two points. And I think if we can address that, then I think we will go a long way to ensure we have a shared vision, better collaboration, that we can all be sure that we've chosen to prioritise the right things. And it doesn't matter what agency you work for, whether that's the public sector, the third sector, the police authority or the NHS, you will all be working towards the same end goal. And we're not there.
Mark, just come in briefly before I let Gina.
And I think we've been round the table at the Health Committee when we've had this conversation, and I've had a conversation with Colin at local. I've been around the committees, basically, what I'm trying to say. But the question is, firstly, if we're going to have that difficult conversation about either disinvestment or changing what we measure,
from my perspective, that has to be led by those on the front line. It cannot be something that is led by politicians, because then you just get into a political bun fight where different political parties will say the reason you don't want to measure that is because you're not meeting your target, rather than is it the most appropriate target. So how do we get to a situation where that is led by practitioners rather than by politicians?
I think we're talking collaboration. I'm not sure you can separate them, because what politicians choose to do when they stand up in a chamber, what the media chooses to do when it does like it did this morning, and what practitioners are trying to do on the ground are inherently linked. That's why in our manifesto for the coming elections, we've been really focusing on there has to be a cross-party consensus. If whatever measure we come up with just results in a lot of argy-bargy about minutiae margins, then we've not got anywhere. I think, yes, the focus may be slightly different. The need for what those targets or measures or outcomes are may be slightly different. But if we can't do it in full collaboration, we will keep falling down. So I would urge us to be doing that together.
Okay. We've got eight folk wanting to come in now. So if you'll be patient, we'll get round you all. Jean, to fall by Paul.
I was really wanting to ask about language and position, and thinking about the, everything that's been said, and it's very, very interesting discussion. But at a local level, sometimes the language is completely different between the agencies all coming together, but all using a language that really is quite exclusive. Bureaucrates, I kind of call it. But if you don't understand bureaucrates, it can be quite off-putting at a local level. And I do believe that engagement at grassroots is key to all of this, and the third sector must be part of it. I just feel it won't ever deliver, really, whatever political ambition we have and that shared vision, they need to be involved. And I was interested, Alan, in your paper, because you referred very much to the kind of sacred place that people hold of their own position, and a reluctance often to, you know, because they're firefighting on one hand, to actually think about how they can start to think about preventative work when their entry is full of cases that they have to deal with, and how we translate that at a local level to energise everybody to work together. So I guess my question is, do we start with some kind of training, or how do we deliver that message to engage with across all of these partners that we need to work together?
Speaker, so I think the last point about language I think is really important. I do think in the Police Scotland response I failed to mention this, but when we speak about prevention, I think it's important to understand the distinction between the kind of public health model of primary, secondary and tertiary prevention. No, I actually think sometimes we get around the table and we don't know where we are in the prevention spectrum. So to pick up on Justin's point, if you look at the current cohort in Pullman, Young Offenders Institute, we now know, as much as probably in the last couple of years we've been trying to think about prevention of further offending or reducing reoffending, we now know far more about the current and recent cohorts there about trauma, loss, bereavement that Justin spoke about. We now know that over 80% of them are excluded from primary school. So actually we need to be on the journey of where they were at primary school. And I would agree with Justin's point about, you know, the potential for an extra 1,000 health visitors, but also offer it to the convener. It's not an either or with police and health visitors, you can do both. But I would also just mention a second point to raise in Mr. McDonald's question about working in silos and the potential to work within a four or five year political cycle. I think if we're looking for good practice, you know, something that came to my mind in reading the papers is the National Road Safety Strategy, which has been a 20-year strategy, whilst it's a UK strategy, it's very much been embedded in Scotland over that 20 years since it was launched, I think, about the millennium. Interestingly, just as I was making some notes there, not done through legislation, not done through, to the best of my knowledge, any additional funding, but absolutely has delivered constant improvement over a 20-year cycle, but with a rely, with an expectation that there will be an annual review and an annual progress in benchmarking and monitoring, but also within it, at the launch of it, a very clear understanding of what agency had to do what. So what this meant for roads engineers, what it meant for the car design industry, what it meant for potentially benefit for health, insurers, absolutely what it meant for police, definitely what it meant for educationalists, you know, in terms of cycle safety, road safety, etc., etc. So I think that's a really good example of productive collaboration. I think it's a really good example, you know, to pick up some of Colin's points in his paper, where it's absolutely prevention over a long period of time, but without bending spend or any new money coming in as well.
Just you hear about a 20-year electoral cycle.
That might be advantageous to certain people.
Aileen to be followed by Aileen.
It was really an answer to Mark's point question that he had there. Health outcomes can be measured quite quickly. So the examples that we have with things like local services, where you can prevent people prevent asthma deaths, for instance, by better use. A multi-professional approach with all the health professionals actually inputting at different places, but you can actually measure that quite quickly. So that's where the sustainability thing comes in. You have a local project which is good. It has outcomes. You can measure those outcomes. You can see the difference, but it's not sustained into the next financial year because of the way the budgets work. You never know whether that is actually going to be taken forward, however good something is. And there's also gaps in actually sharing best practice across 14 health boards, you know, so things happening like that. So I think from a health perspective, it's probably easier than some of the other things that have been mentioned around the table on actually getting the outcomes, measuring the outcomes, and it should be easier politically to then say we could take that particular project forward or that policy forward in a much, much bigger way and actually get the national outcomes and traction that we're looking for. On the collaboration, our manifesto has really listed all the things where we think the gaps are on and where we could make changes to use the resources that we've already got, as I mentioned before. Things like the Minor Ailment Service, which would need a review, but it could be available to everybody because it's a historical thing from when we had charges for prescriptions, which we don't have now. So it's a slight anomaly because only the people who used to be free from prescription charges can actually use the Minor Ailment Service. So if that service is suitable for certain parts of the Scottish population, why is that not suitable for everybody? But we've also been working closely with Royal College of General Practitioners, and we're looking at better clinical handovers and referral handovers between the two systems. And we need that for all health professionals. I'm sure Rachel would agree with me on this. It has to be very much better referral system between health and social care, and that kind of feeds into the other one, which is about having access to one single health patient record, which would also help, because at the moment there's information on people all over the place, and to have that held in one place would be very, very advantageous for patient safety and for continuity of care. So initially talking about a health record, which is held, you know, with GPs, but actually going forward we need that to be a health and social care record, appropriate access with patient consent, so that the patients and people decide who gets to see their information at whatever stage in the system. But that would actually help with the collaboration. There is also an element, there has to be a cultural shift of sharing that information as well as the tools to do it, which would be the access to the health record. We also have, there was mentioned about targeting resources. Through the prescribing data now, our specialist public health pharmacists are looking at data which can actually target which parts of the country have a different prevalence of disease or social states, and you could target resources much more efficiently in those areas. At the moment we have very much a one size fits all when we approach things nationally, contractually, but if you find that you've got diabetes is much higher prevalence, or in an old mining area, for instance, you've got much more respiratory problems, you could actually change the way we work, and you could do that for deprived areas. And that's very much in its infancy at the moment, but the data is now there, and we could be very clever about how we use that data. I think that was all from the questions that came up. And we also mentioned, somebody mentioned primary schools. Health literacy was another one we put in the manifesto, because I think we do need to start to teach people more about our NHS from a very young age so that they understand how we make the NHS fit for the future, how to navigate the NHS, where to go at the right time for the right help that you need. And that really has to start in schools so that people understand on the medicines front that there are risks as well as benefits, and actually start taking care of themselves, responsibility for their own care, which, you know, the third sector does very well, self-management and self-care. But we could build on all of that through health literacy from a very young age.
To be followed by Colin.
Point raised about the indicators and measurements of indicators. I think, and I can only speak from what we fund through the Lloyds TSB Foundation for Scotland, I think often when we have quite high level strategic outcomes at local level and national level, organisations feel that they have to be measuring those outcomes, which are far too big and not achievable. So we try and work with them to think, is what is your contribution towards that? So what is it that you can do to help achieve positive change and get them to maybe much more focused and show that change? We've then built up a picture of what that could look like and how it contributes to national outcomes for children and young people and the wellbeing indicators, to show that everybody makes a contribution and we should be looking at measuring that and making a better effective contribution across the board, so people are realistic in what they can do, what they can achieve and how they measure it, and make it accessible so that they're not spend lots of time filling forms and doing evaluations, but actually getting on with the work and embedding it into their practice as they go, and that people are involved in that process as well, so it becomes their outcomes and not owned by a service or an organisation. They're the individual outcomes. I also wanted to mention about the collaboration approach. The Foundation is trying to work collaboratively across Scotland to think about how it adds values. And we've recently launched a new programme where we're trying to reach communities where trust and foundations haven't reached. So we know there are areas there where they don't often have, are not applying for funds, they're not maybe coming forward. So what's the reason for that? And we are working with those communities, individuals there, we're working with local authorities, and we're also bringing additional investment in from other trusts and foundations to look at how we can help support what they want, how they can build out, and how they can link better into the whole community empowerment process. We've just started that, and we're working with East Ayrshire and their Vibrant Communities Programme, but our plans are to expand that, and we're looking at other communities across Scotland to try and see how we can work more collaboratively together, not just public and third sector, but actually bringing in other trusts and foundations and things, and other small businesses and philanthropy as well.
Before by Justina.
I think just picking up on the two big challenges that have been put on the table, how do we break down silos and get integration, particularly around individuals, households and communities who predictably may have poorer outcomes? And secondly, how do we do that on a sustainable long-term base given political and financial cycles? I think the answer to the first one is localisation. And in a way, Parliament's made up its mind about this already. You passed the Community Empowerment Scotland legislation. It says the public sector, including Police Scotland, local authorities, the health service and all its dimensions, on, will produce for each area of Scotland and within that for communities with poor outcomes, a specific local outcome improvement plan with targets. Secondly, you said they must show that having set this plan, they fully resource it and they collaboratively resource it. So you have set a new standard, which will be the framework in which we will be operating from now on in, and I think backing that, you know, that creates an infrastructure that forces us to look in different ways across silos, look at the resources we've got on the ground and how we can exploit them better. I think there's merit in that as long as we stick with it. I think the anxiety, if there is one, about the way politics is practiced, and indeed in fairness, people like myself in public policy practice, we keep on wanting to move on to the next thing without letting the first thing embed. I think this Act is a very big deal if it becomes the core infrastructure to which we operate in Scotland. I think it has transformational potential. In terms of the political cycles and sustainability, I think a lot of our practices in some areas of our work could be looked at with respect to us. I'm impressed at how bold we've been about renewing the school estate in Scotland. So we're making 35, 40-year punts on where population will be, how you'll do education even 20 years from now, quite apart from 40 years just now, because we're locked into the bricks and mortar, frankly, for that length of time, and some of it through PPPs that will continue to cost us very significantly across all that. So in some areas of our lives, publicly, we're extraordinarily bold. We make big judgments and we go for it. In other areas, I think, we tend to shy off. We're not sure about the 40-year horizon and so on. I think it's the big data stuff that Aileen referred to. I think we are now far better placed to understand long-term interventions we need to make. And that includes in terms of our long-term economic planning as well as our long-term public service planning. And I think it is almost being willing to have a national vision in an unashamed way. So it's weirdly, I think, it's about getting our act together at the highest national level so we have long-term plans we stick with, and then localisation right down to the most local level. But that will then include empowering our own staff so they are free to collaborate at the front end with everybody else who's there. And I doubt we can empower communities if we don't empower our own staff, is the frank truth. So my experience is people collaborate really very well when they can see the whites of other people's eyes. It is people like myself sitting in the top of systems who are least good at it. We think budgets, we think about our silos, we think about our accountabilities. People at the grassroots level are often unaware, picking up on Rachel's point, of all of these things that Audit Scotland documented at all. They've never heard of them, they've never read them, they're getting on with real life. So I think that empowerment at the front end, but creating a more coherent database, long-term framework at the national end, is exactly what we need, and it's not a contradictory combination. You need both for either to work.
Okay, thank you. Justina, before by John.
Changed my mind about 10 times of what I'm going to say as the whole conversation's moved on. But one of the points I wanted to make was that I think we need to be careful that we're not doing something that looks like it's preventative but actually escalates people up the system or escalates them into the system. So if I give the example, sorry Paul, of recorded police warnings, which look on paper like a very good, positive, new initiative to kind of keep people at the totally lowest end of the justice system. The risk around that is now 16, 17-year-olds are being pulled into that system, and also that will stay on somebody's record for a couple of years. So if they're used well and properly, that they will keep people out of the system. But it doesn't take much then for somebody to become an offender within that system. And then, as we know from numerous studies, it's very difficult to get back out. And that links maybe to Jean's point about language. And we've worked really hard in community justice to get away from that language of the offender. When we started to have these conversations in the Community Justice Authority, people kept saying, well, what do you call them? And it's amazing how often just the word people actually gets you through. And just finally linking into various points about outcomes and how we measure them. I was at a very good event last week run by the Robertson Trust about learning and impact. And there was an input from the Chief Executive of LAN, Kelly Chase, who are a foundation who have funded a lot of initiatives around multiple disadvantages rather than sort of picking, well, we'll look at addictions or we'll look at homelessness or whatever. And he said, and you could hear the gasps around the room, that we need to stop obsessing about outcomes all the time, because we were like, oh, we thought outcomes were the way ahead, you know. But he said it's the way we operationalise them that can lead us into more silo thinking, because he said it's like if you give a group of young children a football and send them onto a football pitch, they'll all try and score the goal. And the way we operationalise outcomes has become very much like that. We all want to be the ones that hold the service user through to deliver the outcome. And the best collaboration around outcomes is where we are working together at all levels and are happy for somebody else to actually get the glory of that outcome, and we don't always need to hold it ourselves.
Now the huge backlog of speakers has been reduced to a measly three, so John to before by Nick.
You're very measly, convener. Let me make a few general points and then two very specific suggestions, if I may. I want to pick up, first of all, on something that Rachel said earlier on about paradigm shifts. And the thing about paradigm shifts is that, as Einstein said, you can't solve the problems with the same thinking that got you into them. And so this is a little bit about changing our thinking, retraining our brains, as it were, and that has implications for us as individuals, for us collectively, and also for our systems. I'll come back to that in a wee while. Also, want to recognise that in that there is a lot of complexity. It's easy to view things in a binary way, yes, no, right, wrong. This is a very complex, multifaceted area of activity. I was interested in what Mark McDonald, the question you posed, which has been picked up by others about the short-term cycle of political change and gain and need for success. I think one of the really tough issues for politicians here is that this is long-term, and it's inescapably long-term. It requires cultural change, attitudinal change. It requires investment on which there will not be obvious return in a short-term political cycle, although intellectually we understand it's the right thing to do. And I think it presents a real conundrum for politicians. And I do wonder, and I'll just be provocative here, if once again in Scotland we can show folks that there's a different way of approaching this. I think a lot more people get this than you might imagine. And while you may think that the constituents and the voters are looking for short-term returns and will only vote for you if you achieve a certain thing in a short period of time, I just wonder if a large number of folk are that unsophisticated, or if there's an opportunity to set out perhaps a different way of doing things. So
well, can I interject just there, because we did actually have a Labour MP give evidence to the committee a couple of years ago from down south, who thought that what was actually happening in Scotland was, you know, much further ahead of what's happening south of the border in terms of this particular agenda. So even with outside Scotland, I think a lot of people know that we're actually trying to move along this path despite difficulties in terms of financial challenge at the moment. So I think it's been recognised
even by voters
and across the political divide as well.
Yeah. There's lots of examples of that, Convener. I think, so the thing, there's a platform there. So if we're talking about paradigm shift and rewiring our brains, as Einstein would have it, we are in a very good position, certainly better than many others, to try to do that. And that's about political leadership. I wanted just to recognise also that part of this is understanding why the symptoms of difficulty, challenge and resistance exist. And we now know so much more about the psychological barriers that get in the way of this kind of change. And the examples will include an inbred resistance to cultural change just as part of who we are. We know, and I say this uncritically, there are vested interests. In other words, people who have stakes in the present systems, the status quo, who fear loss, who fear change, the point that has been made, Jean, I think, by you and others. We know that people, when something is not urgent, will tend to focus on the urgent and not value in the same way. In other words, they will tend to discount future benefits rather than short-term gains. We know that we are all prone to what's called risk aversion. We know that the system, a fixed system, suffers from what's called system inertia. It's much more difficult to change a system than just to allow it to continue, and so forth and so on. These are all called cognitive biases. And if we can recognise these in ourselves, in the institutions and collectively understand them, we can then begin to develop options to deal with them. And that, I think that, particularly under pressure, that's a real challenge for us, particularly under financial and austerity pressure as people are facing just now. So all of that, and that leads me into the point again that Jean just asked about, which was training and learning. I think, Paul, in your paper you mentioned a collaborative leadership training programme. I think it's hugely about training up a whole generation of folk, leaders and non-leaders, in skills, aptitudes, techniques, processes, competencies, which will allow us and them to work more collaboratively and more preventatively. That's an investment, and it takes an intellectual and practical acceptance of that and what it means. But if I just can turn to, finally, convene a couple of suggestions, because, Mark, you were looking for short-term gains. There are two areas, I think, in which this committee...
I wasn't looking for short. I was talking about the clash that exists between the need for short-term gain or the perceived need for short-term gain versus the long-term solution.
Got
so,
it.
You know, I'm not looking for you to give me anything for a leaflet, John. So, it's okay.
What I'm going to offer you, however, I think are two things that I feel fairly passionate about. So let me just offer them, because I think this finance committee can take a lead in this. We hear more again today about disaster, the challenge with which the government is faced over the computer system which is designed to allocate funding for farmers. Now, it is well known, I think, in the contracting industries that contracts for computer programming and processes, particularly large scale, can never be fixed emphatically in advance. They are always works in progress. And the same applies often to construction contracts. And we've seen in Scotland a number of instances of construction contracts costing far more than they were thought to need to cost at the outset. I think the procurement approach in Scotland could be examined. I think you would find that a more enlightened, less competitive, less black and white approach to procurement in Scotland, and I know the procurement department is trying to do something about this, would save you a lot, save Scotland a lot of money. You get more bangs for less bucks. And
I have to say, most of the big construction projects are coming in on well under budget and well ahead of schedule.
Well, that may be because things have changed. Even in the fourth bridge would be a great example of that. So I take that point. Let's go back to IT. There's more than just the farming situation, the NHS 24 and so forth and so on. I'm just suggesting that there are ways in which one could explore how these contracts are let at the outset, which would bring in preventative methodology. The final example is the justice system. I work largely within the civil justice system as a mediator, helping people to sort out disputes which are otherwise going to court. There is a grievous amount of money being spent in the civil litigation process, even with court reforms, much more than needs to be spent. And it's not just money in direct expenditure, it's time, it's reputation, it's loss of opportunity, and all these which have an impact economically on Scotland and on particular businesses. There's a great deal that could be done preventatively, in my respectful view, to reduce significantly the amount of resource directed at the civil justice system and to increase the economic value that could come within business and elsewhere through nipping disputes in the bud, through early preventative measures and through training and other awareness so that disputes never take off and gain the kind of adversarial momentum that so many of them do.
Okay, thank you for that. Nick, to be followed by Rachel.
Thanks. I think just to pick up quickly on Rachel's point about indicators around A&E waiting times, the Welsh, and whether or not it's the elected representatives or others who should challenge their use. In the Welsh Assembly Government, they took on, when they shifted funds to social care, they took on and they explained that's what they've done. And they've removed a lot of that. They were hammered for ages about their accident and emergency waiting times. And the minister patiently explained and explained and explained, and now they've moved on and they're not looking at it. And that's, I think, what needs to happen, needs to come both from the top and both from the elected representatives and from the workforce, that this isn't an appropriate target. I think the issue on partnership, though, this is key. Everything we found, that partnership working is key to these issues around prevention, but there's a real danger that cooperation and collaboration very rapidly becomes coercion, where the organisation that has the largest amount of money or spent putting the most money into the partnership takes the say. And part of this is to do with the evidence, whose evidence, when you have different sectors coming together, we have using different evidence to justify their way of working, and some of the evidence that comes from some sectors is very hard and based on very large studies and very easy for them to present, versus the evidence that would come from social care or for the third sector, which might be much softer and much easier to dismiss, but actually probably might be more appropriate to apply. So there is a real danger there, a real issue here about how you afford primacy to which particular types of evidence. And just one final point about co-production. The one thing that we've found is that people talk about, well, this service is co-produced, we can now spread it. Actually, it's not the service that's the issue, it's the process. Co-production, every time you start something in a locality, you have to start from scratch. You can't say, this worked in Gorbals, therefore we'll do the same in Govan, or we'll do the same in Castle Milk, or we'll do the same in West of Hales. You've actually got to go to West Hales. What worked was not the service that was produced. What worked was the co-production that led to the delivery of that service. And that also means that those services have to be continually co-produced, and you have to continually be changing them to take account of the changing constituencies that are coming through. So if you design something in Gorbals today, you can't keep it running. You've got to keep on co-producing it. And it means that it's a really intensive, slow and hard to produce service, but you can't just say, we've got a service, we've co-produced it in Gorbals, let's spread it across Scotland. It's It's the process of co-production that's key, not the service that, not the actual resulting service that comes out.
We get 20 minutes less left, and obviously we're now moving on to possible solutions. So, probably folk will only have an opportunity to speak once more. So, please feel free to come up with any ideas that you have at this point. And the first person to speak will be Rachel, to be followed by Justina.
Thank you, convener. I thought you were going to give me 20 minutes then, but that's.
Let's move straight on.
Three points, as this may well be my last chance to speak on that basis. First, I think there's been a number of comments that have come across today around the difference between good intent and unintended consequences. And I think, just as a point of clarification from what's just been said, the RCN is continuing its work on what the future measurement culture should be. We're very happy to continue talking to anyone around this table and beyond about what that should be. We certainly haven't come out and said that there are particular targets that are good or bad. I think there is an issue around the consequence of how sometimes those targets are used. And that was my point about this morning, which was the focus on a very, very marginal missing of a target against the scale of what we're talking about here. The second is really to come back to the point on language. And I don't know if this is a positive for you, but I know that there's a huge amount of work going on, even within the professions, because you can sit a nurse, a social worker, and a pharmacist in a room, and we won't necessarily quite understand what we're each talking about. The RCN's been doing a huge amount of work over the last 18 months to 2 years as we've moved towards the go-live date for integration to try and make sure that we and our members and members of other colleges and other professional bodies are in rooms together trying to understand and trying to get a better dialogue going about what works. We as a college have done a lot of work with the third and independent sectors as well on that basis. Does that mean it's all sorted? Clearly not, but I would say, as it may be some comfort, just to say there is a track that I think that we're on. We, for example, run a day with Social Work Scotland where we brought managers of nursing teams and managers of social work teams in a room together and facilitated them to talk about how do we manage to bring these different cultures and these different ways of working together in a way that makes sense to both of those groups. So work is in hand. Is it going to be quick? Almost certainly not. Will we begin to see some change locally? I would certainly hope so. And that brings me to my final point, which is about locality. And we've been talking a lot about the importance of grassroots and where that drive to this paradigm shift will come from. The Community Empowerment Bill notwithstanding, I think we do also have to just be aware that there is the potential for an awful lot of different localities to start emerging across Scotland, which may not always quite match up. And I think if one of the issues that we're talking about is coalescing the resource that we have, whether that's a community asset, a third sector or independent sector resource or a public sector resource, we have to make sure we're focusing that at locality as well. So, you know, within the Alliance have done some very good work mapping the development of the integration authorities before they go live. And at the last iteration of that at the end of January, if you look at the localities and how those have been set up, every integration authority has to have at least two. They're being done in very different ways in different areas, some around GP boundaries, some around council wards, some around natural communities. Some haven't even got to the point of actually deciding what that locality is. We then have other legislation setting out localities. We have interim changes to the GP contract, which is talking about cluster working for general practice. I do think, again, we have to be clear that we bring together the assets that we have to a single end. And however those bits of legislation or policy or contracts, whatever they look like, are being defined by different parts of government, we have to make sure that we're working together at a local level to effect the best possible change and get, frankly, the best bang for our buck, because there aren't that many bucks around at the moment. So that I would certainly put forward. And the issue then comes one which came up earlier around that political issue around measurement. And one of the areas that we're looking at in our own work is how much willingness is there for there to be difference in measures at locality level? Because what we may end up with, so easily called postcode lottery, but we've just put in place a whole piece of legislation that will involve huge amounts of variation across Scotland in the services people may get and and how they work towards those national outcomes that have been set. That may result in all sorts of headlines, but actually that's what's been put into legislation. So how comfortable are we as a nation, as a parliament, as practitioners, in having variation in indicators across Scotland to meet the national outcomes that have been agreed. And that's a question that we're asking at the moment in our own work.
Thank you very much. Justina, to be followed by Deputy Convener.
In terms of solutions, I think fundamentally we need to stop talking about prevention as such a long-term challenge and as such an expensive challenge. And I think, just slightly challenging what John was saying there, you know, it hasn't taken a generation to half empty Pullman of young people. It hasn't taken a generation to see some real impact of mentoring on people in the justice system. It hasn't taken a generation to, talking about your coffee clubs and lunch clubs and so on, to stop those people feeling so lonely and isolated and to connect them into their communities. I think this is all within our gift, and it's not quite so overwhelming, I think. I liked Colin's sort of glass half full perspective in the written submission, which was about, well, Christie said that 40% of spending is on failure demand, but the flip side of that is 60% looks like it's already preventative. So I think that's a really good starting point to build on. But I think what doesn't really help is the short-term nature of funding. And I think that would be the main sort of solution as far as I'm concerned. And that doesn't just apply to the third sector, but also to statutory services. We might not have 20-year electoral cycles, but I don't think it's impossible to move towards 3 to 5 year investment planning models that look at strategic commissioning between partners, to look at what do we need, those kind of those shared goals that Rachel's talked about, how do we achieve those goals, who's got money to put in together, and how can we best commission those services together. I think all of that is quite achievable and is absolutely within our gift.
Sorry, Deputy Convener, to be followed by Alan.
Thanks, Chair. It was actually in the police paper, there was 3 points that struck me I'd be interested in. They seemed all quite positive. One was the idea of a national Christie champion, quite what that would mean. The second one was that the public remain untested as an asset. And I wasn't quite sure where that would be going and how we use the public better. And the third one was that New Zealand seems to have been a good example of things progressing. I just wondered if you could give us any pointers as to what that meant.
Yeah, I have to say, Paul, that was an excellent paper.
Thanks for that, and I take no credit for it other than being here to comment on it. Sorry, can you, Deputy Convener, the first question was...
A National Christie Champion?
Yes, so I think that point is... Probably the point there is, I don't think there's anybody around the table or probably within... a few miles of here that would disagree with Christie or the contents of the report, but actually where has the drive been to take that forward? You know, and I think when I read it, I recalled the Arbuthnot report, which again you would read into and say there's lots of good work in there and lots of good comment, but actually was there a drive beyond individual leadership within the public sector, within local authorities, police, fire, elsewhere, health, to do anything? So I think it was, not saying I take it or leave it, I think people would look at it and say we agree with it, but it was optional whether you took it forward. It was almost agreeing with philosophy and then you tried to weave it in. So the idea of there being some champion or drive behind it, I think would be helpful beyond relying on single leadership. I think the community's been untested is just a comment about maybe about valuing communities' interaction been untested or misunderstood. The point that Colin made earlier on about, you know, it's not for the public sector to prevent isolation, no, it's for communities to contribute to that. And I think, again, we all know what could be done, but actually how we would move from the positions we are, where communities becoming potentially more remote, individuals becoming more isolated, not just the elderly community, but a whole spectrum of vulnerability, from children sitting in their bedrooms and pretty much been on IT and potentially been exploited or radicalised or vulnerable in different ways, right through to that elderly group that Colin spoke about. And in the New Zealand model, New Zealand have had quite a paradigm shift in terms of moving away from prevention. That isn't to say they haven't kept a focus on crime control, trying to reduce crime and disorder, but they've certainly moved away from large number of performance indicators and targets to three simple measurements. One, reduce crime. Two, reduce the number of people referred to the criminal justice system. And I forget from memory the third one, forgive me. Very much an IT focus, very much an engagement with government to say we need time to make this work. No, we will continue to produce monthly performance figures on about crime, but we really need our reliance on government not to come back in 2 months and tell us that we've lost confidence because a certain group of crime figures are going up or down. Very much community-based. No, I mean, one of the examples in New Zealand is they've managed to close lots of police offices without any public opposition because their message was, we're going to be in your communities with bits of IT in our hand and deliver the services that we used to do for communities from your street corner. And there's been no pushback whatsoever. So you can see, no, I think Police Scotland would like to have learned from that message instead of just finding it out a few months ago, if I was being perfectly frank. But they've delivered basically something that Police Scotland have delivered with an entirely different engagement with the public, an entirely different result, an entirely different level of support from the public and including from within politicians as well. And I think a broader part of the New Zealand preventative approach is very much looking upstream, very much instead of looking at the offender and trying to prevent re-offender, looking at a greater focus on victims. Now, I think Scotland have came a long way in victims in recent years. There's no doubt about that. I think we've got some really good practice in about victims of sexual crime, domestic abuse and others. I'm not as convinced we've got the same level of support and examination of victims of other crime groups, no, whereas New Zealand tend to be looking at victims right across and far more measurements internally, or far more roles focused on prevention and victims than they do have about offenders.
Okay, thanks very much.
Okay, thank you. We've got less than 10 minutes, so folk can keep comments brief. Alan, to follow by Aileen.
Thank you. Yes, the simplicity of the target, it would have been very much my comment here. And just to endorse some of the things Paul's just saying, that simplicity, it's a truism, really, that common sense never attracts funding. We need to be clear exactly what we want. A classic example in the justice field, everything is based around reducing reoffending. Is that what we want? Or do we want to reduce offending? We've kind of not got it right. We've not got our focus right here. So simple targets allow for meaningful discussion. Complex targets create issues and create complex solutions. And we need more simple targets. How are we going to get there is the question. What do we want to achieve is the fundamental thing we need to get right initially. And secondly, the community justice, the development of the Community Justice Bill has been a real eye-opener. Many of us from the third sector have been involved, and the forum that I belong to has been very much involved in the wording of that bill and the formulation of the thinking behind it. It's been excellent. It's been a very long process, but it's been good because the third sector is genuinely written into it. The approach now reflects some of the third sector thinking. Prior to our involvement, there was nothing about the sector in the bill. Absolutely nothing. And you know, that just for me, I'm saying that is an example of good practice where we're actually taking everybody who's involved and getting them involved in strategic thinking.
Aileen, to follow by Jean.
Just very, very briefly, it's just a word about public health. I think if you take a long-term view on the public health, and looking at the bigger picture of public health in the round, there are some very simple solutions which we could use. And people talked about silos. We do have lots of silos. There's lots of different parts of the NHS which have public health campaigns. We don't join anything up at the moment. We have community pharmacies have posters in the windows 6 times a year, and that doesn't join up with anything on the side of the buses or on the TV, drop a glass size, anything at all. And I think there are actually, if we sort of think slightly out the box and have a bit more collaboration, there's an awful lot we could do with very simple solutions which would be very big on the public health picture and would be very long term but wouldn't be particularly expensive.
Okay, thank you for that. Jean, to follow by Elaine.
Thanks, Marina. I just wanted to pick up
on Nick Watson's point about what is right for the Gorbals. Can't, you know, just because we see a really good example, we can't roll it out. But what we can do, I think, is often inspire other people by a good example. We're not saying that's what they did and we have to do it here. But if when we throw down the gauntlet, I think quite often, particularly in local communities, they will pick it up. And part of the, I think what needs to happen is more encouragement and confidence that people can do it, and not meetings where we have agencies saying, well, you know, I don't think you'd be able to do that because, and changing that to, we'd have to challenge this, but giving people the confidence that they can actually make that difference. And finally, just on the long-term planning, I don't see anything wrong. I mean, lots of agencies have it. We're going to be free of breast cancer by 2030. Different agencies have different times. Governments are known to say it too in terms of improving education or whatever. They do put time limits on it. And why shouldn't we aspire to a 25-year plan for Scotland? It shouldn't be restricted to a political cycle, because actually, for the mass of people that are making this work, there is no political cycle in that sense. So we can actually work towards that. And finally, I would just say that one of the really real frustrations in Scotland, and whether it's a Scottish six or what, I don't know, but is just that we are not good at showing ourselves and what is happening across the country. So we end up with huge chunks of the country not knowing what's, thinking they might know, but not actually knowing the reality of what other communities can do and what other agencies do to help them and how it works. And I think that's really has to be part of our thinking for the future, is sharing that knowledge across the country.
One of the issues, but not on a Scottish Six, is that there are people who think the junior doctors are on strike in Scotland today. Elaine, to follow by Andrew.
One, following on from Paul's about our communities and people in them and seeing them as an asset. But I think before we get there, we need to actually think about how we engage with people in the communities. How many individuals responded to this consultation for evidence? How many people knew about it? And if we want to think about prevention, we need to think about how we engage with people differently, reach them in the communities, think about beyond the public meetings so that they can feel involved. So, for example, we could be setting up stalls in the shopping centres or places like that where people go, or there's some examples of work done in supermarkets where people are generally going and you can have a conversation about what's important to them, what they would want. I think we just need to think out the box about how we engage communities and how we build them up as community assets. The second thing is, I totally agree with the fact that people get inspired by seeing good practice and what happens, and we try and encourage networking opportunities to bring people together to share good stories. But I also think, to make things happen well, there is local needs across different areas. I'm not saying that everything will need to be different and one size does not fit all, but there's components underneath that are fundamental that make things work and make things happen. And that is about having a shared vision and a shared aim, so we're all working towards the same thing. Being clear together what we mean by prevention and what we're trying to achieve for prevention. Relationships are really important. It's relationships that make things happen, and being able to talk to each other, have open conversations, be able to come up with any new solutions, ideas, and address the challenges as they emerge, as they will in partnership working. And the other thing is to be flexible. If we can't be flexible and adapt as things progress and move on, then we're not going to try and move forward. So I would say they're the kind of fundamentals we need to think about as we progress in the preventative agenda.
Okay, Andrew, and then finally Nick.
So I'd add my support to what Justina was saying earlier on about longer term funding models. Third sector organisations, some of those mentioned in our briefings, are having a massive impact on people's lives, preventing them from their conditions worsening or preventing them from entering hospital. But they're operating in a one-year funding cycle, and sometimes a shorter funding cycle than that as well. And I think we need to learn more from five-year approaches. So for instance, the National Links Worker Programme, which sits with the Alliance, that's a five-year approach. It's got built-in learning coming from it, which is going to be learnt from going forward in different areas of the country. And I think we really need to learn more from that. I'd also make a plea for more change management capacity to bring us towards prevention. I know that John talked about that earlier on, but also looking at the current models that are driving public service reform. So the Integrated Care Fund, for example, it's £300 million over 3 years. But that in total is around about 1.4% of the overall health budget. We'd like to see that increased so that we're actually talking about something a bit more transformational rather than around the edges, which is kind of referred to earlier on. And so an additional shift in investment there, that's the kind of things that we would like to see.
Okay, thank you for that. Now, Colin seems to think I've got telepathic skills because he does want to come in, but he hadn't indicated, so I will let you in briefly after Nick. Nick?
Just to say that I agree with Jean. We should be sharing what's worked and where it's done it, but it's actually the process that they did rather than how they did and what they did. I think it's a thing to share. I think one final point I want to make is that we need to make sure about workforce issues. There's staff in the process, the public sector and the third sector, facing massive policy changes. One change, health and social care integration, community empowerment. Speaking to people last week, they've got now new national clinical guidelines, both and new mental health guidelines, new child welfare things. These are making massive work changes in the way that people are working. And staff just haven't got, because we've got cutbacks, people don't know if they're going to be in their job next month or in 3 months' time. Everybody's acting reactively. There's not enough space for people to sit down and proactively say, right, what do we do to stop this? And if we want prevention, it's got to be. People have got to have time and space to go away, joint training and joint opportunities to bring people together. And at the moment, everything just feels, it's certainly clear that we're seeing the people, massive policy overload, especially in the public sector around social care, health and social care integration, SDS. These are massively new changes in the way, that, and they've all been rolled out one after another, now new national clinical guidelines, new mental health. Social care, they don't know what's coming next. And I think, you know, I agree that the policy is starting to pull in the right direction, but think of the workforce as well when we make all these changes.
Okay, Colin, briefly, your last speaker.
Brief. We've talked a lot, I think, about public services and the public and the third sector. There are other levers we have, however, around prevention, macroeconomic, fiscal. In my own context, planning, I would particularly emphasise, if you look at what's coming through our planning system in Scotland just now, we are building housing for a population we're not going to be in 30 years' time, and we're building nothing for the population we are going to be. If we do that, we'll have a whole lot of people ending up in hospital 30 years from now because they're having to live in housing that's grossly inappropriate for their age, their frailty, and so on. So I do think we need to think about all the levers government and the public sector have, and that includes regulatory and planning powers as well as our direct delivery and funding of public service. And I think we're underexploiting some of these levers at the present moment.
Colin, thanks very much, and I'd like to thank everyone for their contributions. I think it's been a really interesting and informative debate, and certainly the Finance Committee will produce our legacy paper in a couple of weeks. We'll deliberate on much of what's been said today, so thank you all for your contributions. I'm now going to call a 5-minute recess to allow a natural break for members and a change of witnesses.
reconvene the session. We will now continue to consider progress towards prevention by taking evidence from the Deputy First Minister. Mr. Swinney is joined for this item by Brian Logan of the Scottish Government, and I intend to allow around an hour or so for this session. I'd like to welcome our witnesses to the meeting and invite Mr. Swinney to make an opening statement. I'm afraid it's only a small, but I'm sure you will agree, perfectly formed committee this morning.
Thank you, Convener. The Finance Committee's focus on prevention and budget scrutiny over recent years has been very helpful in framing the debate, and I welcome this inquiry, and I look forward to the legacy report that is formed by the committee. The Government has set a clear direction for reform in Scotland. Prevention is its cornerstone, and I believe we're making substantial progress on that journey. We've seen through real successes in tackling the burdens of preventable disease through improved treatment and progress in helping Scots make better choices to support their own health. The significant changes we have made to national structures, systems and frameworks have created the right conditions for change. An important early achievement was moving to single police and fire services, with recorded crime in Scotland down 5% in 2014-15 to the lowest level in 41 years. The new model for community justice will further strengthen the role of community planning partners in crime prevention and community justice services. And in the Fire and Rescue Service in 2014, the number of dwelling fires was approximately a fifth less than 10 years ago. And the Fire and Rescue Service has significantly transformed its way of operation to support home visits to enhance the levels of fire safety within the home. In the most ambitious reform of health and social care services in Scotland since the creation of the NHS in 1948, we've brought about a fundamental realignment of resources that will build the capacity of community-based services. This will mean that fewer people need to go to hospital, but it will also ensure that where hospital care is necessary, people will return home in a swifter way than before. In Glasgow City, there has been a 75% reduction in bed days lost to delays for people over 65 since December last year. And the King's Fund noted last year that Scotland has made most progress on integrating health and social care in the United Kingdom. Community planning continues to be the driving force for reform at the local level, and the Community Empowerment Scotland Act gives a new impetus to community planning, placing specific duties on public bodies to improve local outcomes and tackle inequalities within local communities. The Early Years Change Fund returns tell us that every community planning partnership has embraced the Early Years Collaborative, which provides a method for delivering change in the way that people are thinking and working to prioritise prevention more effectively. We've invested significantly in the public social partnership model of co-planning, which involves the third sector working alongside a public sector body. The LOMOS prisoner support pathway has resulted in a step change in the way reducing reoffending is tackled, both in the prison and in the community. And an evaluation of the LOMOS public social partnership is being published today. The independent evaluation of the Reducing Reoffending Change Fund was published in February and also provides a positive assessment of the ability of such services to address the needs of offenders. Our investment is designed to support long-term change in the delivery of public services by the investment in infrastructure and investment to support the delivery of effective community services that can meet the needs of individuals within our society. The Government believes we are making progress on this long-term agenda and remains absolutely committed to continuing that journey in the period ahead.
Okay, thank you very much for that opening statement. Much of what you said has been supported by some of the people who spoke at a roundtable session. For example, the RCN said, and I quote, progress is being made by many organisations on the ground in terms of the way in which we're looking at work and prevention, and a lot of sort of the work that the police said, which you've touched on, was also very positive. But of course, the comment was made that we're about 60% of the way towards prevention, so there's still some ways to go. I don't know how that figure is particularly measured, but I mean, and I don't know if you would want to comment it, but there are some issues where there appear to be concerns continuing. For example, the issue of silo mentality still appears to be extant within our public services, and APEX made a comment which basically said that in terms of prevention, channelling most, if not all, funding through local authorities caused intense pressure on these same authorities to retain as much as possible of the available funds to the detriment of success for innovative partnering with the third sector. And we heard, for example, about how
you know, it takes less pressure off local authorities and the health service if, for example, there are lunch clubs run by volunteers, you know, these kind of things which are just loneliness and isolation among elderly people and stop them falling on the kind of expensive services which I've just mentioned. So I'm just wondering what further progress the Scottish Government plans to take forward in terms of delivering, particularly to try and ensure that the third sector is not being squeezed out of the preventative spend agenda.
It's a very important question, Convener, and one that I would want to avoid a situation where the third sector felt squeezed out of the mm-hmm. solutions here. I think the third sector is central to the services. I think what is a challenge is the finding the right models which will enable us to ensure that is the case. In the Christie Commission report, and the Christie Commission's thinking anchors what the government is, what the agenda the government has taken forward on public service reform. But in the Christie agenda, there was an emphasis on place, on essentially drawing together all public service organisations in one locality and focusing on the needs of that locality. And in my experience, that is a very successful way of operating. By its nature, however, that requires us to channel resources through local authorities, who will be the key players in all localities, to ensure that services can be funded in a fashion at local level that meets the needs and the circumstances of people in that locality. And the needs of communities that you represent, Convener, in parts of Ayrshire, will be very different to the type of services that communities require in the areas that I represent in Perthshire. There will, of course, be similarities. But we've essentially taken a view of trying to channel resources to the local level and then enable local decision-making about how that should be deployed. What I acknowledge is that sometimes causes concern within the third sector community, who would rather we contracted directly with those third sector organisations. I think on balance, I think government would find that pretty difficult to do, because we would be in danger of trespassing on good connected work at local level, which is already underway, if we were doing that directly. I think that would be the danger. So I think the requirement is for us to perhaps reinforce some of the dialogue with local authorities about how we can work together to make sure that third sector organisations are able to be influential in how this agenda is taken forward at local level.
I think is very important, and we all recognise that. I mean, one of the things that the RCN said in the previous evidence session was the fact that the issue of locality, though, is that, you know, there doesn't seem to be a clear view of what locality is. So, for example, some of them are based on council wards, such as my own area, for example, and other areas on the extent of GP practices or other kind of ideas of locality. And so there seems to be a kind of blurring as to what, therefore, a locality is and, therefore, what it can potentially deliver.
I think that's there will always be these choices about what's the correct level. And of course, locality in certain circumstances will go right down to streets and individual settlements where people can find solutions for the challenges that they face. So I think the priority is to leave that decision making to localities to design the solutions that meet their requirements. But what we have to insist upon, and perhaps I'll be interested in the committee's thoughts about how we might intensify this process, what we need to insist upon is that all localities contribute to this agenda in the fashion that I have set out, and that we don't have the danger of essentially a sort of swallowing up of responsibilities and activities into the into local authorities at the expense of local discretion and decision making within individual communities.
Thank you. Now, you yourself said in terms of the draft budget report or response to a report last year that well, there's some evidence of change at a local level. We need to see this replicated more quickly and at a greater scale. Culture change is necessary and will only be achieved through greater levels of integration of public service partners. And the pace of progress being made by community planning partnerships needs to increase markedly. And I'm just wondering if you think in terms of, developing a single joined up coherent framework, whether that's actually happening. You know, there's been any big shift in the last year in terms of that?
I think we, to go back to your first and opening question, convener, we are on a journey here, and I'm not going to sit in front of the committee and say the journey is over. It is not. We're still on the journey. I think we are making more progress on that journey. I think on the three areas that you talked about there, convener, of culture change, increasing role of community planning partnerships, and the pace of change, I think on all three, I think we're in a stronger position than we were when I responded to the committee last year. But I don't for a moment believe that it is job completed as a consequence. So we still need to think, we still need to encourage the change of culture and attitudes to break down boundaries between public services. We need to encourage more integration and cohesion amongst community planning partnerships, and we need to continue to increase the tempo of change within our public services.
Confidence that that's actually taking place. Are there any kind of examples of any short-term preventative initiatives which you believe could be taken forward over the next few months, for example, just to let people know that the government key drive in that area is continuing?
Well, I think the key drive that in the next few weeks, convener, will be right across the country, the integration of health and social care on the 1st of April. And that will be, that must be a service change that is visible and discernible to members of the public in a very short space of time. Because fundamentally, if we, you know, in public policy, we spend an infinite amount of time wrestling with structures and processes. What's really at the heart of integrating health and social care are the individuals who are required to use these services. And the integration of health and social care is a very person-centred process where we design services to meet the needs of an individual rather than to configure the propositions and offerings of two significant bureaucracies, the health service and the local authority, to perhaps meet the needs of that individual. So health and social care integration allows us to go to the other end of the telescope and to look at the issue from the perspective of the member of the public who needs to experience integrated services to support their requirements. And that's really at the heart of the agenda we're taking forward.
I mean, I welcome that progress that's been made, but does it go far enough? I mean, I'm thinking about, for example, in Ayrshire, we've got three local authorities, and we have had to set up three integrated joint boards, each of which has to separately work with the health board in terms of trying to deliver a structure which one would have thought we could do much more seamlessly across Ayrshire if we'd perhaps a different structure. I mean, one of the things that, for example, was discussed also was how the planning system and the regulatory framework could be improved to help deliver on the preventative spend. So the integrated joint boards, I mean, they seem to me almost a kind of clumsy response. Do you know what I mean? There's not, because it still requires not only joint working between health boards and local authorities, but willingness for both of them to collaborate, cooperate, and there's an issue about personalities in some of these, you know, as you can imagine.
Well, I think there will always be issues with personalities, convener. If we could remove that from the challenges that we face, well, life would be an awful lot more straightforward. And that's not a reflection on the dynamics of the organisation of which we are both members. But I think that my view of health and social care integration is that it's not about joint working. It's about changing the way we work. And that's why I make my point that the service that a member of the public experiences has to be different. You know, if we've been blunt about it, members of the public often can be passed from pillar to post in the public services in the area of health and social care. Now, that has to stop with the integration of health and social care. So a member of the public interacts with health and social care service, and they must experience a joined up collaborative proposition. That is the key requirement of health and social care integration.
And do you feel that in terms of prevention, it's considered to be now
a kind of core aspect of delivery, or do you think it's still by many organisations in the public sector considered to be a kind of add-on that they, you know, that they may wish to do, but it's not at the centre of what they're trying to deliver?
Since
cultural change is what we're trying to
do. I do think it is. I happened very recently to be involved in a situation in my constituency that involved a fairly intense level of GP care for an elderly individual. And I was overwhelmed by what I experienced of preventative planning by a GP, the objective of which was to avoid an elderly constituent having to go to an acute hospital. And the level of preventative planning that that GP did, in their judgment, because this would create a better outcome for the elderly member of constituent of mine, I was enormously impressed by how that was undertaken. And the easiest thing for the GP to have done would have been to call for an ambulance and get my constituent taken to Perth Royal Infirmary. But their judgment was their needs would be better supported in a different pre-planned preventative way, and that was undoubtedly the right judgment to have made.
But the question then, of course, is how widespread is that approach?
Well, I detect within the system a much greater propensity to undertake that type of activity. That's one snapshot. There'll be other examples of where services are being. I gave some examples in my opening remarks about the Fire and Rescue Service, for example. The Fire and Rescue Service, to me, is one of the leading examples of an organisation that has absolutely reconfigured its purpose. Quietly and carefully. Of course fire engines still go out to put out fires, of course they do. But the overwhelming majority of the activities of the Fire and Rescue Service is about fire prevention now. Now, it's a tremendous credit to Chief Fire Officer and his staff around the country for the way in which they have exercised that responsibility. And when I go around my constituency to gala days, community events, various events and all the rest of it, the Fire and Rescue Service is there patiently, quietly, punting the message about fire safety to vulnerable members in the community. And I think it's a tremendous testament of how a service which, I don't know, 5-10 years ago was a predominantly reactive service is now predominantly a preventative service. And I think there are numerous examples of how that's been taken forward across the country.
I mean, I would agree with that, certainly from the evidence that we received earlier on, but I mean, Apex made an interesting point. They said that in the criminal justice system, which you touched on, we're at crime at a 41-year low, the focus is on about reducing reoffending, not about offending in the first place specifically, which I found interesting. I don't. We didn't get any contradiction from our chief superintendent, who was actually here, just also in the same session from that. So there's an issue about how to ensure that the correct measures of prevention are being used.
Well, that's right, Kevin. I think the reducing reoffending example is very encouraging about the shift of emphasis. But I think Apex give us a salutary reminder that one of our priorities must be to reduce offending in the first place. So that's not going to be just an issue taken forward by the criminal justice system, and actually it's more likely to be taken forward by the strength and the quality of our education system in terms of nurturing and supporting young people to avoid going down the route of offending. It will involve a heavy dependence on the effectiveness of parenting to encourage young people to take the correct path in life. It will depend heavily on the proactive intervention of a variety of third sector organisations. I had cause to encounter a young man who was involved in the Prince's Trust. He'd set up his own business in the Prince's Trust. And he freely told me that he was heading for a very, very troubled life. But he had been referred by a social worker to the Prince's Trust, where he had been introduced to the Prince's Trust Business Development Service. He was a, you know, let me say, he was a pretty creative individual, so he might have prospered in a life of crime, but he decided to prosper in a life of business, made a connection with a retired army officer who was working through the Prince's Trust. And the conversation I had with these two individuals, two people from two different backgrounds, you could never, you know, the difference in their backgrounds was colossal. But there was a respect between these two individuals. The young man freely volunteered that if he hadn't encountered this retired army officer, he probably would have ended up in a total mess, and he'd been taken seriously by this army officer. So they're in the third sector is an example of an organisation focused on delivering better outcomes for young people and directing them away from offending, where this young man quite clearly could see he was heading. The reason I cite these examples is not to say there's not one organisation that will be the custodian of trying to avoid young people becoming involved in offending. And when we get to older age groups, that was inadvertent. In older age groups, there will also be a requirement to encourage people to change their lifestyles to avoid getting into offending, and there will be other interventions that have to be undertaken to take that forward. So these examples I cite to demonstrate it has to be a whole system solution. It can't just be we rely on organisation X to stop people getting involved in offending. It's got to be a whole range of different organisations playing their part.
Okay, thank you. Just one final question, I'll open up the session, and that's disinvestment, or you may want to call it reinvestment. What evidence is there that that's actually taking place at any scale?
I think the whole concept of disinvestment is quite a difficult one for us to tabulate, because what I would accept is that public expenditure is spent in a different way today than it was spent 5 years ago or 10 years ago. Now, do we call that disinvestment? Maybe we should call it disinvestment to give it a harder edge. But undoubtedly, money has been spent in a different way as a consequence of reform. And I make no apology for that. I think it's a good thing. And under health and social care integration, money will have to be spent in a different way to how it's spent just now, because we must get reform out of this process of change.
Okay, thank you for that. So the first colleague to ask questions will be John, to be followed by Jean.
Thanks, convener. We had a very good session just now with quite a number of witnesses, and one was Colin Mair from the Improvement Service, and he was really challenging even the questions we were asking. And also raising the whole question about, you cannot really say that a particular pound is a preventative pound. You know, it's very hard to measure, and he's arguing that even if prevention is succeeding, we will not necessarily see a figure moved from this bit of the budget to that bit of the budget. But my problem with that then is that, how do we measure it? And we're the Finance Committee. Can we tell at our level if it's actually happening, if there's more prevention? Because if it's all about attitude, how do we measure that?
Well, I don't think it's all about attitude. I think we should have measures of performance that enable us to test whether or not we are delivering a more preventative range of public services. So, for example, I agree with Mr. Mayor that it is impossible to go through the budget and say, well, that's a pound for prevention and that's a pound for reaction. I think that's really difficult to do. But over time, and these things need to be measured over time, you can look and see, well, as a consequence of our policy interventions, and this is the whole purpose of Scotland Performs, over time, are we reducing reoffending by our policies? And the answer to that question will be yes or no, because that's measurable. Mm-hmm. Will we be reducing emergency admissions to hospital, unscheduled emergency admission to hospital, given the change in the dynamics of our population? Because our population, as the population ages, then the risk of unscheduled emergency admission grows higher. in the context of those expected changes in trends, are we actually reducing that volume of activity? And you know, these things are all measurable. So I think we should have a pretty hard look at Scotland Performs, and you know, the government has launched Scotland Performs back in 2007. We've adapted it and revised it on a couple of occasions. I'm very open to it being challenged to create a framework that would enable that. In my view, that's what it's there to do. It's there to see, are we making progress on these big questions? And if it's not telling us, that it doesn't give us the right information to do that, then let's change it. Mm-hmm. Let's reconfigure it. And you know, if we have an indicator, for example, that says we want to increase the proportion of young people going to positive destinations out of education, well, that I take that as a proxy for, you know, good outcomes for young people. So we should be quite comfortable with that. Mm-hmm. If we're looking at offending, if we saw offending rising, that would be a bad outcome. So we'd have to look at our policy mix to say, well, what can we do differently to get that out, that indicator to go the other way? Mm-hmm. So I think it's through that performance framework that we undertake this work. But I would be very open to the committee and to Parliament. I've engaged in this issue with Parliament across the political spectrum on the effectiveness of Scotland Performs. I'm completely open to whether or not that actually does what we would like it to do.
Yes, I mean, my feeling is that people are comfortable with the concept of Scotland Performs and the kind of bigger aim or outcome, and Colin Mair was certainly arguing for outcomes, maybe even less to talk about prevention. The RCN, though, raised questions about the NHS and targets, and is that really helping prevention? Because there can be a focus on what we can easily measure, like A&E waiting times, and it may not be as easy to measure, you know, quality of mental health provision in the community, kind of thing.
Yeah, I think that's a pretty fair point, to be honest. And I've listened to a lot of commentary from professionals across a number of different sectors who say that some of the targets that we follow are not particularly conducive towards getting to measuring whether or not we're making progress on the improvement in outcomes. So again, you know, that's something that I think we should be open to considering.
Okay, thank you.
There will, of course, be a political desire within political debate to have some of these hard measures. You know, yeah. Mr. Mason and I sit at question time on a Thursday lunchtime at noon, and sometimes the government's performance against some of these measures is the subject of some debate.
Yes.
In the parliamentary chamber. Heaven forfend.
Absolutely. We've mentioned the third sector already. I just wanted to go back to that because Alan Staff, who was here from Apex, was arguing quite strongly that in the preventative side of things, the third sector is better than the public sector at doing that kind of preventative work, mobilising volunteers, all of that kind of thing. Would you agree with that? Is that going too far, do you think?
I think the third sector is very, very good at contributing towards prevention. I don't think they are the exclusive players that should be delivering prevention. I think the public sector must be delivering preventative services into the bargain. But I think the third sector has got a tremendous track record to be very proud of in terms of delivering preventative interventions. But it's not something that we should just say, well, we'll leave prevention to the third sector. I'd be completely against that, because this needs to be a concept that is owned and advanced by everyone in the public, private and third sectors.
Okay, thank you. And my final point was the police came up with the idea of a national Christie champion, you know, somebody that would really, well, Christie's obviously wider than just prevention, but I think that's quite central. You know, somebody that would really be up there all the time, you know, kind of challenging us all about this. Do you think that's a useful concept?
I think there is merit in that idea. And I think government needs to look at how we advance this agenda. Some of these points come back to what I discussed with the convener about the degree of progress we're making on the journey. You know, ministers evangelise about these points regularly, and we are constantly pushing and pushing and pushing. Colin Mair is a very good example of somebody who pushes and pushes and pushes on these questions, and there are many others likewise. But there is, I suppose that, you know, if I had to make a choice between having a Christie champion or a public sector that was motivated by delivering Christie, I'd choose the public sector motivated by delivering Christie over there. That'd be my first choice ahead of a Christie champion.
Okay, that's great. Thanks very much.
Okay, thank you, Jean, to follow by Mark.
Thank you, convener. This morning, the paper we were given by the Scottish Community Justice Authorities quoted John Carnahan as somebody who made a case, apparently, to you, I guess, in the last parliamentary session, calling for the Scottish Government to invest in 1,000 new health visitors rather than 1,000 new police officers. Now that we have 500 new health visitors, was he right?
I generally think Mr. Carnahan is broadly correct on most things, to be honest. I suppose I better go and look at his Twitter feed to see if I agree with absolutely everything he's ever said. But I think generally, like, John Carnahan's been a fabulous advocate of preventative intervention, and his, and not only advocate of, you know, Mr. Carnahan has justifiably can be proud of the record he's delivered in violence reduction, which has been one of the most significant developments in our society in many years. So the and his the argument that he advances is about taking steps to ensure, I suppose, that everyone gets off in life on the right footing. And that's essentially the simple concept that lies behind the rationale of his thinking. And in that respect, I think he is absolutely right.
Yeah. Good. One of the statements that has stayed in my mind from the earlier discussion was from Aileen Bryson, from the Royal Pharmaceutical Society, where she said that we only use 50% of the medicines, and that 50% equates, and I'm sure she said this, I might have to look in the report, but it's second only to salaries. Now, I don't know off the top of my head what an NHS salary bill is, but I'm sure you probably do. But it's a lot.
But the pharmaceutical bill is a big bill. Yes, it's whether
well, it's it may be that she meant. I didn't have time to ask, but that seems to be an area where and it's something that also that we hear people in, you know, everyday language just talking about the fact that they got a prescription with 40 pills, but actually after the third one, they couldn't take them, or they had to take them back, or they were on a trial, or they didn't use them. Is there are we interested in that in terms? Particularly given that you know, should we say, some of the opposition parties or other people are calling for a reintroduction of charging people who can afford it for prescriptions again, believing that would contribute to public services. But it just seems to be an area that is worth investigation.
Well, we certainly are very much interested in prescribing and prescribing practice and the implications that has for the pharmaceutical bill within the National Health Service. So yes, we are very interested in that, and the Health Secretary and I work very closely with the Chief Pharmaceutical Officer to ensure that health boards are managing very carefully prescribing practice. Obviously, to get a prescription has got to be issued by a qualified practitioner. For that to happen, a judgment has to be made that prescription is necessary. So, you know, I'm not a qualified medical practitioner. I can't second guess what a medical practitioner decides an individual member of the public requires. But that should be, you know, that should be their consideration. And certainly the prescriptions should not be and will not be issued unless they are required by individuals. I think it takes on to a second point, which is about general health and well-being. If I generally look after my health better than I was looking after it before, I'm going to be less likely to require a prescription. So it's not just all about GPs and clinicians getting their prescribing practices correct. It's about every citizen thinking, well, actually, you know, I really should look after myself a bit better and keep healthier. And as a consequence of that, perhaps make my own quiet contribution not to requiring many prescriptions. And that's, so there's a wider preventative agenda must be to encourage citizens to take a greater interest in their health and well-being. And some of the examples, you know, if you take some of the we can take forward some pretty bold health improvement messages. The ban on smoking in public places, introduced by the previous government, supported by this government. Indeed, the concept of it was advanced by the convener of this committee many years ago in his youth. But that has made in a very short space in time a discernible difference in the health and well-being of newborn babies in our country, and it is absolutely measurable and tangible, that public policy reform. So there will be general health and well-being reforms that will contribute significantly to the enhancement, to the reduction in the need for prescribing. If a baby is born and doesn't have asthmatic difficulties because they've not been nurtured in the womb in a smoke-filled environment, then we'll be the beneficiaries of that as a society for many, many years thereafter. And for every one case where that happens, and the health improvement amongst the newborn baby population in Scotland since the ban on smoking in public places is one of the most success, one of the pieces of evidence of greatest success in public policy.
I quite agree, Cabinet Secretary, that certainly getting everyone to take fewer prescribed drugs is desirable, but at the same time, I think that do you agree that there are questions to be raised about pharmaceutical companies, about how we buy drugs, the cost of drugs, the potential for saving on the drugs industry in Scotland, that there is an opportunity there to maybe in some cases expose some practices, but certainly to these figures of 50% not being used is worthy of more than encouraging people not to go to the doctor.
I suppose, I suppose I come back to my core point about prescribing. Medical practitioners are under an obligation, whatever a pharmaceutical company does. And the pharmaceutical companies, if pharmaceutical companies didn't do what they do, then we wouldn't have drugs that are saving people's lives today. So I think that's really important. And it's then up to medical practitioners to prescribe appropriately and be mindful of the resources that are involved in their prescribing practices. I think it's also, there is an issue about, I looked at some data which looked at the performance of individuals taking medication to deal with COPD and the relationship between that and unscheduled hospital admissions. And essentially, there's a direct correlation between poor performance in taking drugs to deal with COPD and unscheduled hospital admissions. The moral of the story being, if people had actually taken their drugs as they were told to on the packet, they wouldn't have ended up in hospital. And that's where I come back to my general. If a doctor goes to the trouble of saying to me, here you are, Mr. Swinney, take these tablets and do this and do that. If I'm interested in my health and well-being, I feel pretty obliged to take seriously what my GP has said to me.
Thank you. One of the other issues that arose was the potential for much longer term planning and the kind of joint vision that we would have for Scotland and spreading that kind of political message and highlighting how we want people to work together to prevent all kinds of things from loneliness to, communities working well, caring for each other, not taking medication, being healthy and having all of the agencies signed up and working in that way. And it seems to me that there's a potential for doing that. Other agencies, I made the point, do have, plans to eradicate breast cancer by 2030, plans to do other things. That shouldn't be stopped by political parliamentary session, should it?
It shouldn't, and I don't think it is. I think the when we formed the government in 2007, I would say we continued broadly the direction of travel that had been established by the previous government over an eight-year period, where we were, I'd like to think that we've intensified it, we've focused it, we've obviously undertaken different policy choices on different issues that mattered to us politically and for which we had a mandate. But in the core message and approach of what we're trying to do to improve the quality of life of people in Scotland, if I give an example, the previous government spent a large amount of time in the early part of this century trying to tackle the three big killers within Scotland in the health service. Now, when we came in 2007, we didn't say, right, okay, that's coming to an end. We carried that on. Why? Because it was the right thing to do. Now, we're able to broaden out onto wider topics and wider challenges because such an impact has been made on the three big killers in Scotland and such an improvement has been made in the outcomes for individuals. So there is I've cited the ban on smoking in public places. We were enthusiastic opposition supporters of that ban on smoking in public places. We were right behind the government to do that. And we've just, I think our approach on alcohol consumption, to me, is the extension of that general approach that we inherited from the previous government. So I don't think there's of course there's been different things. We do, we believe in different things and we focus on different things compared to the government that preceded us. But on a lot of other things, much more so than we would normally admit at 12 o'clock on a Thursday downstairs, there is a general scope of agreement of the right things to do to improve the health and well-being of people in Scotland.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. And that's Mark to be followed by Leslie.
thank you very much, Convener. A number of the points I was going to raise have come up already. I wanted to ask about change funds and whether you felt that the change fund had been used appropriately, I think is maybe the term I would use, across Scotland by local authorities. I've heard evidence of a very good use of change fund monies, which have delivered new ways of working, which have since been mainstreamed. But in other areas, the change fund money was used to effectively fund short-term projects that have now been shelved, even though they had been demonstrated to deliver very good outcomes for the individuals who were using those services. Do you think that there's been a mixed approach taken in terms of change fund?
I think generally the change funds have generated a good new and reformed practice in the delivery of public services. If I have one regret about them, well, probably two regrets about them. One is that I'm sure there will be examples where the money could have been better spent and more effectively spent. I'm sure there must be. I can't think be naive not to believe that. My second regret is that by establishing change funds, which were worth about £500 million over a three-year period, we rather were at risk of giving the impression that they were the pockets of money to drive the change, not the 60 billion of health and local government spending that was being spent at the same time. If I'm making that point clearly enough, I think we could have had. The one danger of setting up a change fund is people think, well, we've got this change fund over here, which is 500 million, we'll spend this on change stuff. Meanwhile, we'll spend this £60 billion the way we've always spent it on health and local government. And that misses the point. The point is, you should be looking at your £60 billion to say, is this the right way to spend the money to deliver the aspirations of prevention, place, people, performance in the Christie Commission, or do we need to do that differently? Mm-hmm. And I think that's just a lesson I've learnt from that process, which is why we now are advocating our case much more strongly on the basis of use the money that is available in mainstream expenditure to meet the range of different challenges that we face as a society.
Mm. obviously a number of local authorities have moved to a priority-based budgeting approach. It's something we rolled out in Aberdeen when Sue Bruce was the chief executive. There are a number who haven't made that transition yet. What can be done to try and move that on so we move away from the old sort of salami slicing model that existed in terms of how local budget setting takes place to a more priority-based setting, which would, I think, perhaps focus into the areas around Christie much more clearly?
I'm a strong supporter and advocate of priority-based budgeting, and I think if you have a clear policy framework and apply that to expenditure in whatever area of activity you're involved in, then it will, I think, serve you well. We face an issue about local government. I've members may have noticed I've come in for some criticism for insisting upon certain things with local government in recent weeks. We leave it to local government to decide their priorities and their way of working. I can't dictate to local government, you must do priority-based budgeting. I can encourage it and motivate it, but I can't require it because local government, local authorities are self-governing institutions.
Okay. And then finally, I think it fits in with what Jean Urquhart was asking about the sort of the short-term fix versus the long-term vision. And I absolutely hear what you're saying in terms of the things that the government continued on from the previous government. We've got things around, for example, the 2020 vision around the NHS. But there are still some areas where, in order to get that focus on prevention and the longer-term approach that might be required in some areas, although we heard some very compelling evidence earlier that there are a lot of short-term fixes that can be done which would meet the aspirations of prevention. But in terms of the sort of longer-term vision of if we are going to put funding in at this stage and we might not see the benefit of that for 5 to 10 years, how we ensure that we keep a consensual approach around that and we don't have people breaking off and saying that service X is going to be removed when in actual fact the reason service X is being removed is because it doesn't fit the criteria of delivering prevention, but we're creating service Y over here which does.
I think the measure of all of that has to be how strong is the argument for and the justification for the particular priorities that you're trying to affect. I think that's what it comes down to, how effectively can that be marshalled and put together. And I think that's the key challenge. And also how much effort can be put into creating a unity of purpose around these questions. And that's crucial. If we are unable to create a unity of purpose, then we will be at risk of short-term changes of direction, which will be detrimental, and we have to avoid that at all costs.
Okay. Thanks.
Thank you, Leslie.
Yes. Can I just ask? Colin Mair from the Improvement Service noted the importance of long-term budgeting to reduce future budget pressures. And Nick Watson, Professor Nick Watson from, where's from? What Scotland had mentioned about the need for sound and robust economic modelling. So I was just thinking, so what's the Scottish Government doing on that front with respect to future investment, but also disinvestment?
What we're doing is we're giving the policy leadership to all of this, which is what the Christie Commission was all about and what the Christie Commission produced, and our response to the Christie Commission through the pillars of developing people, concentrating on place, improving performance and moving to prevention. It's the policy framework within which we operate. Secondly, the emphasis on locality planning through community planning partnerships has been crucial in creating the expectation that public bodies had to work at local level to agree shared priorities. Thirdly, the allocation of resources in a fashion that would encourage and motivate changes of performance, whether that's the change fund or the integration or money for health and social care. And then finally, I suppose, establishing organisations like What Works Scotland so that we can share best practice of what is achieved in one part of the country with other parts of the country, which is at the helm of what Professor Watson takes forward in an independent, in a space independent of government, but designed to drive that agenda.
Okay. Can I just refer you to the note from RCN Scotland? They mentioned just under central government, and just to quote their paper, it says, the way in which the current Scottish budget is split, scrutinised and allocated by portfolio does not allow for easy conversations about the consequences of, for example, increased or reduced investment in housing or social care on health spending or outcomes.
I think the in my 9 years of experience in this role, there is no easy way to present a budget that suits everybody. So the way I present the budget is largely driven to suit the Finance Committee, whether I manage that or not. It's to try to show some comparability on expenditure. But there is a serious point that underpins Leslie Brennan's question, which is, we are obliged. We've got to set out the numbers somehow. And you can't just say, well, the budget's going to be £30 billion and we'll just leave it at that. You've got to disaggregate that. The question, the really serious question, is whether the definition of our budget by portfolio is an impediment to good joint working, where we can, for example, see that if we invest sensibly in housing, it is likely to create, better quality housing is likely to create a better environment for people to live, therefore reducing their health issues because they're not living in housing that's inappropriate for their needs. And because they've got a house, they've got an address, they've got a greater chance of being employed, and they therefore can make their economic contribution to society. Now, that all of those policy interconnections I recognise and acknowledge, and I will be, I would be the first to accept that no challenge in our society is ever sorted in one neat little compartment, away over in a budget line. Very unlikely for that to be the case. It's going to be a product of integrated thinking and management and planning and design. So ministers put in that strategic direction to the budget proposition to try to reach those objectives. And then with the devices that I talked about earlier on, of the emphasis on Christie, on community planning, on the degree, on the breaking down of compartmentalisation and silo behaviour within the public sector, these are the devices that we use to try to avoid the situation arising that Leslie Brennan quite fairly puts in front of me could arise if there isn't a connection between. I'd like to think Parliament would point out to the government if they thought our actions on one area of policy were contradictory to the actions in another. Indeed, some colleagues do that. Patrick Harvey's name springs to mind. But there's policy choices were made there about invariably transport connectivity. I wouldn't ascribe all of those difficulties to the way we define the budget. I think what it's more to do with is the point the convener raised with me at the very outset, which was, do we have a sufficiently broad enough culture to see that, for example, what goes on in early learning and childcare in Scotland might actually make a contribution to avoiding a young person ending up in being incarcerated mm-hmm. when they're 18.
Yeah, no, I accept that. I think one of the difficulties, I suppose, is that joint working, where you think if you've got an older person in a home and you're with my local councillor hat on, trying to get an adaptation to avoid a fall. So an adaptation may cost the local authority £1,000, but actually the prevention or the benefit of that fall is then not being taken up because it's a sort of fall and the cost is then on the NHS.
That's actually probably one of the best examples of it. That you know, to put a handrail on somebody's an old pensioner's bathroom wall, which might cost 60 quid, but if that person falls getting in and out of the bath, well, I may as well write a blank cheque, because the ambulance will have to come. The distress to the old age pensioner is enormous. Their health condition will be worse because they've not just had a fall, they've had the shock of a fall. A&E has to deal with that. A&E might be dealing with 101 other things, but they will be dealing with 101 other things. And so it goes on. So it's a very, it's probably the best example of it, yes. And of course, that is where the salami slicing difficulty can arise, where a public authority thinks, we'll trim that provision a little bit, and in cash terms, it's a small amount of money. But the implications of that can be quite significant in other areas of the public purse.
Can I ask a follow-up on that? No,
just on that as well, and I think the point Leslie Brennan makes is a very strong one. Is there also a difficulty in the sense that if the local authority is not the one seen to be capturing, if you like, the benefit of the expenditure? So the benefit of the expenditure would be in terms of reduction at the NHS end, that because that whole picture is not necessarily being looked at, because they're looking purely at their own circumstances, there is a risk then that those budget decisions are made in such a way that the benefit is not felt overall.
But that's where it is necessary to ensure we embed the culture of prevention, because you know, it's incompatible with a culture of prevention for a local authority to say, right, we'll just not do adaptations in houses anymore, because that then, because we know what will happen, the people will fall, it's the shoes night follows day. So it's about, I think it gets back to the point the convener raised with me at the outset, which is about the culture of prevention.
Okay,
move on to, sorry, there's a comment from Aileen from TSB. She had said about the need to recognise that small projects such as breakfast clubs are the first to be cut from local authorities when they're feeling under pressure. So it was, I think everybody recognises the work that third sector organisations do. And we had heard from Alan from Apex that they're good at mobilising local communities, including volunteers. But I suppose we do need to be cognisant of the third sector, if it's not a statutory responsibility, given the pressures that local authorities are under. I'm sure it's across the board, all local authorities. In Dundee, a couple of years ago, it was a 5% cut, and in every other budget, there's been at least a real terms cut if it's a standstill budget. So how do we support the third sector if they're very good at preventative, but actually recognising that actually it's under extreme budget pressures?
I think, well, my view on that is that we have to embrace reform. And that was one of the central messages of my budget statement in December, was about, in a challenging financial climate, we have to embrace reform. I don't think, if I look at different scenarios around different parts of the country, in the local authority budget round, there's been a variety of different proposals put out there which people would find wholly unacceptable, and they've not been taken forward by local authorities, despite the financial pressures. And that's because I think there's a recognition that things have got to be delivered differently, and that's what... That's what we need public authorities to do, to think about reform and delivering public services in a different way to how they've delivered them before.
Okay, one last question. I suppose it is about that embracing the reform, but in some organisations, thinking of some of the, in the NHS, when you're already delivering a service to people who already have health needs now, so they already have, like, whatever, cardiovascular disease or diabetes now, but at the same time we're seeking investment into reducing health needs in the future. So how do then, what would you advise for those organisations that have to commit to the sort of double spending
of meeting the needs now and planning for the future.
Well, it's about it's part of a wider policy argument. If I go back to some of what I was the issues I was discussing with Jean Urquhart, we are taking steps now to encourage individuals to take a greater ownership of their own health and well-being. And if we do that, then that will reduce the number of people presenting themselves to GPs requiring medical treatment. And that will reduce demand throughout the system, because that those issues will not percolate their way right through the system. So as we see those messages become gaining greater ground, we can see the benefits of that flowing through the system. And I don't think I don't accept the argument that people have got to run double services. I think what people have got to do is to ensure that they operate within this approach that I've set out in a fashion that reduces demand on services and then enables us to act in a different way to meet the expectations from members of the public.
Committee, do you have any further points that you wish to put forward at this point?
Nothing else to add to that. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm now going to call a 2-minute recess while we have a changeover of witnesses. Okay, our next item of business is to take evidence from the Deputy First Minister on the Draft Budget Scotland Act 2015 Amendment Regulations 2016. Mr Swinney is joined by this item for the second by Scott Mackay of the Scottish Government. I'd like to welcome our witnesses to the meeting and invite Mr Swinney to make an opening statement.
Thank you, Convener. The Spring Budget Revision provides the final opportunity to formally amend the Scottish Budget for 2015-16. This year's Spring Budget Revision deals with four different types of amendments to the budget. Firstly, a few funding changes. Secondly, a number of technical adjustments that have no impact on spending power. Thirdly, a small number of Whitehall transfers. And finally, some budget-neutral transfers of resources between portfolio budgets, including a modest budget redirection to ensure we maximise our available budget. The net impact on all of these changes is a decrease in the approved budget of £2 million, from £37,409.6 million to £37,407.6 million. Table 1.1 on page 5 of the supporting document shows the approved budgets following the autumn budget revision and the changes sought in the spring budget revision. The supporting document to the spring budget revision and the brief guide prepared by my officials provide background on the net changes. The first set of changes comprise mainly of two deployments of Barnett consequentials to health, as per the Scottish Government's commitment to pass on any received Barnett consequentials in respect of changes to the Department of Health's budget and to local government following the widespread damage and flooding caused by the storms in December and January. In total, these changes increase the budget by £42.2 million. The second set of changes comprise a number of technical adjustments to the budget. The technical adjustments are mainly non-cash and therefore budget neutral, as they cannot be redeployed to support discretionary spend elsewhere, and have a net negative impact of £115.3 million on the overall aggregate position. It is necessary to reflect these adjustments to ensure the budget is consistent with the accounting requirements and with the final outturn that were reported in our annual accounts. The third of these changes relates to a reduction of £138.6 million required for the NHS and teachers' pension schemes, reflecting updated estimates from Her Majesty's Treasury based on the most recent available factors and scheme information. Again, this is a technical adjustment to the budget, and this reduction in funding required cannot be used to support discretionary spending elsewhere. The Scottish budget aligns with the accounting requirements under the Government Financial Reporting Manual. Accordingly, the budget provision is included within the Scottish budget for the financial year to reflect the recognition of relevant health and transport assets within revenue finance infrastructure schemes in accordance with the accounting requirements. The adjustment to budget at the spring budget revision is £110.1 million. Other technical adjustments include increased AMI budget to cover provisions, impairments and fair value adjustments to other non-cash adjustments to the portfolio budgets. With regard to Whitehall transfers and allocations from the Treasury, there is a net positive impact on the budget of £70.7 million. This includes additional funding of £60 million to meet the costs arising on police and fire pension schemes as a result of the final judgment in the Milne versus the Government Actuaries Department case. The final part of the budget revision concerns the transfer of funds within and between portfolios to better align the budgets with profiled spend. There are a number of between portfolio transfers as part of the revision process. These have no impact on overall spending power. The main transfers between portfolios are noted in the SBR supporting document and the guide to the SBR. In line with past years, there are a number of internal portfolio transfers which have no effect on portfolio totals but ensure that internal budgets are monitored and managed effectively. As previously mentioned, the committee will wish to note that as part of our robust budget management process and in line with good practice, we've taken the opportunity at the spring budget revision to deploy emerging underspends to ensure that we maximise public expenditure in 2015-16, in particular to support capital investment where possible. The spring budget revision also reflects the proposed transfer of budget from resource to capital in respect of the Scottish budget, noting that the Scottish budget records capital that scores in the Scottish Government's consolidated accounts or the accounts of our directly funded bodies. In the context of the Treasury budget, the planned resource to capital transfer is £15.3 million. This switching is managed within the total DEL available to the Scottish Government. This takes into account the latest profile of the Government's overall capital programme. As we approach the financial year end, we will continue in line with our normal practice to monitor forecast outturn against budget, and wherever possible, we will seek to utilise any emerging underspends to ensure we make optimum use of the resources available in 2015-16 and to proactively manage the flexibility provided under the budget exchange mechanism agreed between the Treasury and the devolved administrations. I confirm, in line with past years, that it is my intention to make a statement to Parliament on provisional outturn in respect of both our Scottish Parliament budget and Her Majesty's Treasury budget. The brief guide to the spring budget revision prepared by my officials sets out the background to and details of the main changes proposed, and I hope that members have found that helpful.
Thank you.
you very much for that brief introduction. As always, there'll be a few opening questions for myself, and then we'll move on to colleagues around the table. The first one is in regard to carryover of 2015-16. It was previously indicated that £150 million of 2014-15 carry-forward was to be used as contingency to address the potential need to reclassify NPD projects as public sector. I'm just wondering whether it was required and whether resources available in 15-16 have been affected as a result.
The provision was required in to deal with the issues arising out of the reclassification issue. We have managed that and deployed that, and budgets in 2015-16 have not been affected adversely as a consequence.
Okay, thank you for that. And the Spring Budget Review states that Table 1.7 on page 10 provides a complete picture of capital spending, but the table doesn't allow for establishing a picture of resource to capital spending, to capital transfer by portfolio. I'm just wondering what resource budgets have been reduced to accommodate capital increases, or what changes have taken place since the draft budget 15-16 was set out?
No, well, resource to capital transfers take place within portfolio. Mm-hmm. So it's essentially a matter that portfolios will wrestle with to most effectively utilise the spend allocated to them to meet their resource and capital priorities and requirements. And essentially, I monitor that and manage that to ensure that that process is undertaken effectively by portfolios.
Okay, thank you for that. And, last year's brief capital spring budget revision contained further details as to these emerging underspends. Bless you.
Excuse me.
No such details provided in this year's brief guide. I'm just wondering why.
Well, essentially, in the budget document, or the budget document we've set out, we've taken steps to reallocate where we see emerging underspends within the changes that are visible on the Spring Budget Revision document. Mm-hmm. Obviously, we remain in quite a fluid situation for the remainder of the financial year, so that position is likely to change between now and the end of the month, and I'll be actively managing that to maximise the utilisation of resources for current priorities and future priorities.
But how is that different from previous year, where it was included and the details were included?
Well, the details will be shown in the further documentation that's available as part of the Spring Budget Revision document.
Okay, Mr. Kay.
I was just going to. We don't have the same level of emerging underspends as we've had in previous years.
Mm-hmm. All right. Okay. What kind of level are we talking about then?
Well, we're currently forecasting only a very small underspend at the end of the year.
I know. What does that mean?
Well, but that's something that we'll keep under management. There's a variety of issues I'm wrestling with, which will have to be addressed between now and the end of the financial year. What I can't imagine we will have done in previous years is indicate the level of anticipated underspend at this stage. We can be clear with the committee about what the parameters are, but we'll obviously manage that very carefully right up to the end of the financial year.
And we'll get that in the June outcome for next year.
Yeah.
Okay, thanks. There's a £30 million transfer from Whitehall to the Student Awards Agency Scotland in respect of loans, which doesn't appear to be mentioned in the supporting document or page 24 of the brief guide.
This is a non-cash budget, convener, which sits within annually managed expenditure. And essentially what is required with that is to take account of changes to the economic factors that underpin the assessment of student loans, and provision has to be made for the proper accounting for those factors.
Okay, and just for one final point, in terms of the justice portfolio, 12.7 million pounds is being released in emerging planned underspend from the Scottish Prison Service on page 38 to support priorities. I'm just wondering if you can tell us a wee bit about what those priorities are.
There'll be a variety of different issues that have to be addressed within the justice portfolio, where you know, some of them may relate to issues around provision of services. They may result. They may relate to some issues in connection with pension provision. They may also relate to some of the wider pressures that are experienced within the portfolio. But we've simply allocated resources to ensure we can meet those requirements.
Okay, thank you for that. Colleagues, have any questions? Leslie?
Thank you. Can I ask on page 7, with regards to health, wellbeing and sport, it says that in the health budget, there's a rephasing of budget for the National Sports Centre of 7.8 million in the operating budget, which has been taken from sport. Could I just ask why it's been moved from sport to health?
Well, essentially, the sport budget sits within the overall health and wellbeing portfolio budget. There wasn't a requirement for that level of expenditure to be undertaken in 2015-16, but it will be required in 2016-17. So we're simply making provision for that resource to be utilised in this financial year on other priorities, and the commitment will be put in place for 16-17. For the National Sports Centre. Okay. So it's just a timing issue.
Okay, but that's it's now sitting under health. Okay.
But only to essentially provide a timing bridge for the resources to be used in 16-17.
Okay, so I couldn't have just stayed in the sport budget then.
What I tried to do is I tried to minimise underspends within any given financial year where I possibly can do, and we're required by the agreements that we have in place with the Treasury to maintain our spending as close to required as we possibly can do. So we try to deploy resources to avoid emerging underspends across portfolios.
Okay. Can I ask, under education and lifelong learning, the 3.8 million that's been transferred from health to Scottish further and higher education with respect to nurse education, which intuitively does seem to sit, you would think it would sit within that budget, the further and higher education budget. Can I just ask, why was it originally put in the health budget?
There's a whole host of transfers which historically have, nurse education is a very good example of it, where the money is provided for in the health budget and it's transferred into the lifelong learning budget in year. It's a characteristic of budgets over time. I suppose if these things can always be changed, I change them from time to time. What it can sometimes be difficult to then do is to enable the Finance Committee to go back to our conversation in the previous session to make like-for-like comparisons of budget developments. So it's always been like that.
Okay. Can I just ask, under the Justice heading, it says a deployment of 2.6 million and 1.8 million underspend to support the costs of domestic abuse and the cost of the mobile communications respectively. So that's 2.6 million for domestic abuse, just for resourcing?
Yes.
In year?
Yeah.
Okay. And lastly, just about the, under infrastructure investment in cities, the ferry service sees a reclassification from indirect to direct capital. Can you just talk me through that?
That will relate to the treatment of the capital expenditure and whether it sits on the government's capital asset register or it sits on the capital asset register of a subsidiary company, such as it'll be CMAL. Is it CMAL or David Brain? CMAL. So it's simply about where the capital, and I suspect that will be to do with new ferry purchasing, which we will have purchased, but the capital asset is sitting not on our asset register, but on one of our subsidiaries' asset registers, and that relates to the accountancy rules that underpin the presentation of the budget.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Any further points? There are no further points. Deputy First Minister, is there anything else you want to?
Nothing to add, Chairman.
Okay. So we've concluded all questions on the spring budget revision. We therefore move to item 4, which is the debate on motion S4M 15433. I invite the Deputy First Minister to move the motion.
I move the motion in my name, Chairman.
Is the committee agreed? The committee has indicated its agreement. I'll now suspend the meeting briefly to allow changeover of officials. Our next item of business is to take evidence from the Deputy First Minister on two more pieces of subordinate legislation, this time in relation to the Landfill Tax Scotland Act. Mr Swinney is joined for this item by Dave Carucci and John St Clair of the Scottish Government. I welcome our witnesses to the meeting and invite Mr Swinney to make an opening statement. Mr Swinney.
Convener, the Scottish Landfill Tax Standard Rate and Lower Rate Order 2016 specifies the standard rate and lower rate for Scottish Landfill Tax as I set out in the draft budget. These proposed rates ensure that the tax burden increases in line with inflation and match the planned UK landfill tax rates for 2016-17 as provided in the Finance Act 2015. In setting these rates, I am acting to avoid any potential for waste tourism through material differences between the tax rates north and south of the border, whilst also providing appropriate financial incentives to support delivery of our ambitious waste targets, including our zero waste goal that no more than 5% of total waste should go to landfill by 2025. The Scottish Government forecasts that we will generate revenue of £133 million from Scottish landfill tax in 2016-17. This full year forecast has again been endorsed as reasonable by the independent Scottish Fiscal Commission. The Scottish Landfill Tax Qualifying Material Order 2016 sets out material that qualifies at the lower rate and the qualifying conditions that have to be met. The lower rate of tax recognises that there is a relatively low level of environmental impact associated with the landfilling of certain wastes which are less active or polluting in the environment. This order replicates the Scottish Landfill Tax Qualifying Material Order 2015 and adds a testing requirement for fine waste particles, often referred to as waste fines, to help ensure that the lower rate of Scottish landfill tax is applied consistently and equitably across the industry. The Scottish Government consulted on a testing regime at the end of last year following calls from industry that the Scottish Government should consider such a measure. Feedback from the waste industry illustrated a feeling that the current system is open to interpretation, with the potential for landfill operators, waste carriers and producers seeking to gain a competitive advantage by interpreting the guidance in a liberal way. The inconsistent way in which landfill operators were applying the lower rate of tax was felt to be driving down prices at the expense of more advantageous treatment options further up the waste hierarchy. The majority of respondents were of the view that the introduction of a statutory testing regime would help provide certainty and create a level playing field, with the application of the lower tax rate on fine waste residues being placed on a more scientific footing. The establishment of a testing regime will help Scotland to continue to benefit from the important role that landfill tax has played in driving waste away from landfill and in creating the stable policy landscape needed to underpin long-term investment decisions on infrastructure and collection systems. These measures will also ensure that the main testing parameters will be broadly similar to that in the rest of the UK. It will be for Revenue Scotland to determine in its guidance the frequency of testing and sample-taking procedures required. The test will not be the only determining factor. In accordance with Revenue Scotland guidance, visual inspections and waste acceptance criteria checks will also be required to ensure that the material disposed of consists of qualifying material as listed in the schedule of the order. Convener, I recognise the change in the order will require industries to procure relevant equipment or arrange for appropriate contracts to be put in place. I therefore propose that the order comes into effect on the 1st of October 2016 in order that the Waste and Secondary Resources Sector can put the necessary arrangements in place for the testing of waste fines.
Thank you for that opening statement. I have no questions myself. Deputy Convener?
Yeah, just on the rates that are being chosen, I mean, I take the point that we didn't want waste tourism and that was discussed when the initial bill was passed. I mean, is it the intention that we would always match the UK rates?
I obviously would want to reserve my position to set tax rates on an annual basis, and ministers would wish to do so. I think what has been in our minds as we implement this new regime is to avoid any potential for waste tourism, but we have to take judgments that are appropriate to the circumstances within Scotland, and obviously ministers would want to reserve the right to set a rate that was appropriate on an annual basis.
I mean, is there any risk that the UK government changes rates at short notice, or do they tend to, on this issue, they tend to give longer term notice?
They tend to do this on an annual basis, but they obviously have the flexibility, which of course we discussed as part of the Land and Buildings Transaction Amendment Tax Bill just yesterday in Parliament, the fact that we can be vulnerable to those shorter term changes that can emerge.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, Leslie?
Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what the cost of this uplift will be to local authorities? Have you done work on that?
I don't think I have in front of me a discrete number, but I certainly will endeavour to provide that estimate to the committee.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you. That appears to be the conclusion of our questions. Therefore, move to item 6, which is a debate on motion S4M. 15815. I'd like to invite the Deputy First Minister to move the motion.
I move the motion, Premier.
Thank you. Does the committee agree the motion?
Yes.
The committee has agreed the motion. We now move to item 7, which is debate on motion S4M 15816. I invite the Deputy First Minister to move the motion.
Move, Premier.
Does the committee agree the motion?
Yes.
The committee has agreed the motion. I'd now like to thank everyone for their attendance today, that being the end of the public part of the meeting. This will be the final public meeting in the session, so I'd like to thank everyone who has given evidence to the committee over these 5 years in which I've been convener, the myriad members of all parties who have, and none who have contributed as committee members, and not least to yourself, Deputy First Minister, who has appeared at this committee more than most of the members who actually now form it. And of course, it would be inappropriate if I didn't also thank our clerks who have done sterling work and indeed the official report over these last 5 years. So with that, we'll now move into private session. So we'll just take another couple of minutes break to allow a private session to...